What do they say about Indiana weather, Coach? Wait a minute, it'll change. Well, guess what? It has changed. Big change from yesterday, certainly. And now the Cougars ready to hit the playoff trail here beginning today. Did not play last week. Now, the opponent did play last week, and they won a big ball game. But let's talk first about your team and the week off. And tell us back, and how did that fare for you?
Well, I think, you know, after 10 football games, it was good for us. I guess we'll find out today how good. But we were a little banged up and didn't put the kids in pads all week. So our bodies got to heal. And, you know, I think this is important to them. Playoffs are important to them. Back in the regular routine this week, and I thought there was high energy and focus. And so I'm optimistic that we'll play hard and well today.
Not concerned about losing maybe some sharpness. He played so well 2 weeks ago in the first half, especially against Davenport.
Yeah. No, I don't think so. My biggest concern today is how the wind is going to affect the long ball and the kicking game. Long ball is a big part of who we are, so we may have to be more patient today.
Is it fair to say, because of the wind, going to affect both teams, they love to throw the ball as well, that maybe the team that can run the ball and play some pretty good defense and stays away from turnovers might be the real key?
Yeah, I mean, there's so many factors into this. You know, a day like this, I've seen punts go the other way, you know. So, yeah, you got to deal with the elements. You know, we talk to our kids. We preach all the time about mental toughness, and it is overcoming anything that interferes with us obtaining our objective, whether it be weather, opposition, whatever it may be. And there has to be a real focus and effort in order to make sure that you're mentally tough and ready to go.
Let's talk about Missouri Valley. We were out there to Marshall, Missouri, back in 2011. Tough ball game. In fact, just two touchdowns in the fourth quarter decided it for St. Francis. Obviously, a different Missouri Valley Viking team. What do you see on film about the Vikings?
Well, they have a freshman quarterback who is just a playmaker. He's small. He's 5'9", 180 pounds, but you can't catch him. Big part of their offense is scramble drill. You know, so you've got to contain a scrambling quarterback, and we really haven't had to do that this year, so it's going to be a real challenge for our defense. Offensively, I think the conditions will be a factor.
Jeff, hopefully that suits you okay. Well, it's on to the getting ready head here for our airtime in just over 2 minutes.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, let us introduce you to the rosters from both teams participating in today's first round football championship series contest. First, for the visitors on the scoreboard, the Missouri Valley College Vikings. Number one, Jake Bridges. Number two, Ricky Williams. Number three, Jacoby Ballard. Number four, Dorian Stenard. Number five, Nate Desimone. Number six, Stephen Thayer. Number seven, Jonathan Battle.
I see they've adapted. In years past, they had both teams standing out there in the cold.
Number 10,
and introduced each one in. None of them are out there, which is good.
Khalil Smith. Number 14, Siobhan Richardson. Number 16, Austin Johnson. Number 17, Jake Kirk. Number 18, Devon Henry. Number 19, Cedric O'Hara. Number 21, Stephen Seals. Number 22, Rayshawn Parker. Number 23, Big Spears. Number 25, Angel Ramos. Number 26, Gregory Johnson. Number 27, Taylor Pillade. Number 28, David Robinson. Number 30, Justin Gallegos. 32, Jake King.
Cougars ready to hit the football playoff trail today, hosting the Missouri Valley Vikings here today at frigid Darcy Stadium. Hi, everybody. I'm Joe Parson. No Sean McBride today. He's under the weather, out ill, and I think really Sean saw this weather forecast. Anyway, we will soldier on alone here today. St. Francis did not play last week. Missouri Valley did, beating Mid-America Nazarene 31-17. Even with that win, the Vikings dropped one spot in the final NAIA poll to number 12. But MVC does bring a sparkling 9-2 record to Fort Wayne. This will be the second time the teams have met. Back in 2011, USF traveled to Missouri Valley and won it 28-14. USF, as we mentioned, idled last week. They still kept a hold of the number 4 ranking in the final poll. Cougars won at Davenport University two Saturdays ago, 35-6. A lot better weather conditions a couple of weeks ago. Cougar defense kept the Panthers in check, limiting to Davenport just a lone third-quarter touchdown, and that was it. Meanwhile, quarterback Nick Ferreira threw 4 touchdown passes, 2 of them to Seth Coate in the win. Today, though, will anybody be able to throw? The end result may well depend on who can muster a running attack and avoid turnovers. We'll take a timeout and then return with Cougar coach Kevin Dowling, get his assessment of today's playoff challenge. This is Cougar Playoff Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3, Northeast Indiana.
Number 1, Charles Gaston. Number 3, Javon Carr. Number 4, Lee Stewart. Number 5, Jarrell Holman. Number 6, Rocky James. Number 8, Nashawn Lewis. Number 9, Pearson Harnish. Number 11, Seth Coke. Number 13, Nick Ferrer. Number 14, Clay Cenarius. Number 15, Nate Carson. Number 17, Justin Green. Number 18, Shannon Swain. Number 19, Sean Boswell. Number 20, Blake Schumacher. Number 21, Ryan Johnson. Number 24, Emmanuel Evans. Number 25, Jack Gibbons. Number 28, P.J. Dean. Number 30, Spencer Cowherd. Number 31, Marcus Stepp. Number 32, Malachi Mannion.
Well, it's on to the playoffs. We're with head coach Kevin Donnelly, and what do they say about Indiana weather, coach? Wait a minute, it'll change. Well, guess what? It has changed. Big change from yesterday, certainly. And now the Cougars ready to hit the playoff trail here beginning today. Did not play last week. Now, the opponent did play last week, and they won a big ball game. But let's talk first about your team and the week off. And tell us back, and how did that fare for you?
Well, I think, you know, after 10 football games, it was good for us. I guess we'll find out today how good. But we were a little banged up and didn't put the kids in pads all week. So our bodies got to heal. And, you know, I think this is important to them. Playoffs are important to them. Back in the regular routine this week, and I thought there was high energy and focus. And so I'm optimistic that we'll play hard and well today.
Not concerned about losing maybe some sharpness. He played so well 2 weeks ago in the first half, especially against Davenport.
Yeah. No, I don't think so. My biggest concern today is how the wind is going to affect the long ball and the kicking game. Long ball is a big part of who we are, so we may have to be more patient today.
Is it fair to say because of the wind going to affect both teams? They love to throw the ball as well. That maybe the team that can run the ball and play some pretty good defense and stays away from turnovers might be the real key.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many factors into this. You know, a day like this, I've seen punts go the other way, you know. So, you got to deal with the elements. You know, we talk to our kids. We preach all the time about mental toughness, and it is overcoming anything that interferes with us obtaining our objective, whether it be weather, of opposition, whatever it may be. And there has to be a real focus and effort in order to make sure that you're mentally tough and ready to go.
Let's talk about Missouri Valley. We were out there to Marshall, Missouri, back in 2011. Tough ball game. In fact, just 2 touchdowns in the fourth quarter decided it for St. Francis. Obviously, a different Missouri Valley Viking team. What do you see on film about the Vikings?
Well, they have a freshman quarterback who is just a playmaker. He's small. He's 5'9", 180 pounds, but you can't catch him. Big part of their offense is scramble drill. you know, so you've got to contain a scrambling quarterback, and we really haven't had to do that this year, so it's going to be a real challenge for our defense. Offensively, I think the conditions will be a factor that we've just got to overcome and handle the football, take care of the football, and hopefully Nick's strong enough to cut through the wind and make some plays, which I think he is. So they're a good football team defensively. You know, they gang tackle well. They're a pressure team. They have a lot of cover variation on the backside. So good opponent. When you get to this point, they're ranked number 11. There are no bad football teams. They're all good football teams. And they've had a rich tradition for years and years. And got a good coach. And they are well coached. And I'm sure they're excited about playing.
You know, what caught my attention a couple weeks ago, they were at Baker, had Baker down. The Wildcats were down until the final minute, and Baker came back to win that ball game. But this tells me this is a resilient team that does have some talent.
Yeah, they're not going to quit. I mean, you're going to have to play 60 minutes. They're tough kids. You can tell that. And they're going to fight you all the way to the end. So we've got to buckle up and play every down today.
Head coach Kevin Daly in his 19th year, the only coach that the Cougar football has known. They come in ranked number 4, 9-1 overall on the regular season, 5-1 this year in the Mideast League. Also here at Darcy Stadium, 4-1 this season. A year ago, the Cougars finished 11-1 and champions of the Mideast League at 6-0. As far as Missouri Valley, the Vikings at 9-2. They dropped a spot in the final poll to number 12. They are 4-1. Finished second place in the Heart of America Conference South Division behind Baker, and head coached by Paul Troth in his 15th year. A year ago, they were 6-5, 3-2 in the HAAC-South, and they lost their final two games during the season. By the way, this year, the Vikings on the road, they are 5-1. Waiting for the teams to come out, our meeting at midfield, the coin toss and kickoff in game number one of the hopefully, from a St. Francis standpoint, a long tournament trail. We will find out. Brutal conditions. We'll tell you about that and much more when we return after this one-minute timeout. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3, Northeast Indiana. Okay, let's just run the two. Back at Darcy Stadium, Joe Parson with you today. No Sean McBride under the weather. Hope he gets feeling better. And hopefully we have a game next week here at Darcy Stadium, and Sean will be back with us. There are two other teams also qualifying for the playoffs in the NAIA. They are meeting, in fact, one another today, a little south of us down in Indianapolis, as Marion, undefeated, ranked number 1, 10-0. They will host Robert Morris. The Eagles at 7-3. Those teams did play during the regular season, and Marion won it handily, 45-7. Well, the final 16 here today, all across this nation, beginning the tournament playoff trail. Well, we've got the Missouri Valley Vikings out already. USF just coming out right now, at least the co-captains. And our referee today, David White. 37 degrees here at kickoff. He will not reach as high as 40. Snow showers, a lot of wind, steady at about 22, 23 miles an hour out of the west-northwest. And a wind chill today in the mid-20s. And we are expecting gusts today as high as 40 miles an hour. So not very conducive weather conditions for football, but again, it is November. By the way, I want to congratulate St. Francis defensive end Lucas Sparks. He's been voted the Mid-States Football Association Mid-East League Defensive Player of the Year. Finished ninth in the NAIA regular season with sacks with 9.5. And just a really great competitor, and he'll be relied upon here today with his leadership along with Pearson Harnish and the rest of the defenders. David Wang with the co-captains, again not able to bring you that meeting at midfield. We'll just try to keep our eyes on what's going on and sort out who will be doing what to begin this football game. Vikings will call the coin toss as the visitors. And David White just getting ready now to flip the coin, and he does catch it. He doesn't let it hit the ground. St. Francis won the toss, deferred. So let's take a 1 minute timeout, and or I should say a 30 second timeout. And we will be back with kickoff as the snow beginning to really materialize here now. Bigger flakes at Darcy Stadium. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. I couldn't hear you over the... Yes, sir. Yeah, gang it all together. Darcy Stadium, it is getting dark. I'm a little surprised they've not turned on the stadium lights. The wind and the snow really emerging. Cougars won the toss, deferred. They'll kick from right to left, and I mean it's getting darker by the second. As USF will kick from right to left, Cougars will be defending the south goal. So the Vikings will have the first opportunity to do something with the football. Jacoby Bellard back in kick return. He had three last week, averaged over 20 yards a kick return, had a long of 40. Also looks like Kenny Sanford is back there as well. Now they're going to make a change on that. It'll be Devon Henry. 5'7 junior. So Henry and Bellard back deep. And we'll see what the wind does with the Ryan Nix's kickoff. It is a crosswind out of the west-northwest. As we look at it, it'll blow footballs to the far side of the field, to the east. And it'll be a challenge for to keep hands warm and to keep the football dry. Well, they now have started to turn on the stadium lights. And we'll see how this goes on this kickoff. Nix is ready, looks for the go-ahead, gets it from the officials, and just then the ball blew off the tee. So we'll wait just a few seconds more. Well, when you consider the weather conditions, not a bad crowd on hand. You've got to be a true football fan today. They're not expecting a deep kick. Now the returner's coming up outside the 10. Here comes the kick, long end over end, far side. Bellard runs up to it at the 15, works to the hash mark, spins back, pedals across to 25, and out just short of the 30-yard line is where the Vikings of Missouri Valley College will go to work offensively, first and 10. It's an offensive line that averages 278 a man tackle to tackle. Troy Jones at center, Brandon McDonald, Brendan Latham are the guards, and Anasai Satoa, 320-pound junior at one tackle, and Jay Atherton, a freshman, 6'4", 265 at the other tackle. Jake Bridges, he's a freshman quarterback, sets up out of the pistol. Lineman Kenny Sanford is the running back. And here is a quick throw, and they've got a catch near side. That was a quick hitting play, and right to the hands of Devon Henry. So Henry, and what does that tell you?
Devon Henry.
Bridges not intimidated by the weather, and now the snow beginning to stick to the field here at Darcy Stadium. They'll have a gain to the 42-yard line, first and 10. Javon Richardson, who had two touchdown catches last week, wide to the left side. Empty backfield now as Bridges takes the snap, wants to throw again. Has time, throws, and there's a wide open grab inside the Cougar 40, and it'll be taken down inside the 25-yard line. That was Richardson. Check it, Dorian Stenard. Stenard, a 6'2 junior, who had five catches last week, 125 yards and one touchdown, and has got them knocking on the door now with two quick hitting plays. It's first and 10, Missouri Valley at the Cougar 22-yard line. Boy, there was nobody around Stenard on that reception. Pistol alignment once again for Jake Bridges. Young freshman quarterback, just 5'9", 180 pounds, does lead him with seven rushing touchdowns. Play clock at 10. As he wakes for the snap now, looks to hand it off to Sanford. Sanders slipped the tackle, upended inside the 20, and cartwheels his way down to about the 16, 17-yard line. They'll say the knee hit at the 16. That'll be a gain of five, second down and five. That's the first running play of the ball game.
Gain of six, make it second and four from the Cougars' 16-yard line.
Opening possession of the ball game. Again, rapidly developing snow on the field here at Darcy Stadium. And it all happened right at kickoff. Again, the work from the right side hash mark now. And Sanford again looking to feel his way right side. Has got running room, and he will hit inside the five and go into the end zone for a touchdown. So it'll be a 16-yard touchdown run by Kenny Sanford. An impressive drive as St. Francis just not able to maneuver on the turf here. And at the 13-19 mark, it is a quick 6-0 lead for Missouri Valley.
For the Vikings, number 16, Austin Johnson.
Sanford just rode the line of scrimmage down to the right side till he got escaped containment into the end zone to make it 6-0 in favor of Missouri Valley. Now the extra point, Austin Johnson on. And a line drive kick is on the way, and that is good. So a quick 7-0 lead. Vikings have stung the Cougars in the early going, and we'll be back after timeout. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana.
Kirk Jones, the official ring manufacturer of the NAIA, providing rings for an exclusive circle of champions.
Back at Darcy Stadium, a crowd kind of stunned how easy Missouri Valley maneuvered into the end zone as they lead to 7-0, and Kenny Sanford now with his seventh rushing touchdown of the year. last week against Mid-American Nazarene, 16 carries, 67 yards, and a 7-0 Viking lead. Bunch lineup now for the Vikings. Justin Green back in kick return, waits somewhere inside the 10. Rapidly disappearing yard lines. Here's Green looking to catch the ball, and momentum carried him to the right side. Works back to the 10. Middle of the field now, comes near side, 15, 20, got a block. Splits defenders, still on his feet across the 35 to the 40, and he rolls all the way out to about the, let's see where they're going to mark him down, at about the 43-yard line. So a good return by Justin Green, who 2 weeks ago had a long of 38 yards at Davenport. Has been averaging about 27 yards. A kick return gives St. Francis very good field position. First and 10 at the USF 44-yard line is where they spot it. We will see how the Cougars are able to respond to the Missouri Valley touchdown that's given them a 7-0 lead. Green again working off tackle. Slips a tackle. Midfield 45-40. Cuts inside. He's behind the defenders. They try to push him out of bounds and finally catch up to him around the 10-yard line. So Justin Green with a good run. First the kickoff return, and now the Cougars will be on knocking on the door trying to tie up this football game. Mark Plummer finally caught up to him with a touchdown-saving tackle. They say they footstepped out of bounds for Green back at the 16-yard line. First and 10. Monte McDowell in wide to the right side. Now they'll bring Aaron Harrison as the running back. Nicodemus off on the left wing. Here is the stretch run, and Harris slips one tackle, slips another, works off to the right side. Somebody lost a helmet out there. The gain is down to the 11. That'll be a gain of about 5 yards.
Cut one to play by 45, Patrick Overby, and number 92, Justin Aguiar.
Gain of 5 for Aaron Harris. Leads the Cougars with 10 rushing touchdowns. 2 weeks ago had 5 carries and a rushing touchdown. Now with a ball at the 11-yard line, second down and 5. Cougars working from the right side hash mark. Ferrer stepped up to the line of scrimmage. Brian Gegner, the center. Motion now by Nicodemus to the right side. They'll run it to the left. Cut it back is Harris. Trying to fight his way inside the 10. Got a couple of more yards to the 8. It'll bring up a third down call for St. Francis. Keegan Bruner was out for one snap. He now comes back in. I think he lost the helmet. Nick Shoemaker came in there.
Brings up third down and 2.
So third down and 2, USF. McDowell splits to the short side. To the right inside him will be Akeem Kelsaw. Cougars have not attempted a pass. They go into the goal line offense now on third down and short. Under center, Ferrer looks to hand the ball off. Here's a plunge to the left side, off tackle run. And it was Nicodemus that got the call and brings it inside the 5 to the 4. It'll be first and goal for St. Francis. So on the opening drive, Missouri Valley concentrated on throwing the ball. USF has had a couple of long gains by Justin Green, and now Aaron Harris doing the tough work along with Nicodemus. Goal line offense still in. Under center is Ferrer. Takes the handoff, looks to hand to Harris again. Off tackle run, looking to get to the goal line, and he's in from 5 yards out. So the Cougars respond with a running touchdown. Aaron Harris, his 11th of the year at the 11:03 mark. And so far, not much in the way of defense by either team.
Under attempt, yes, the point of the Cougars will be number 88, Ryan Nix.
Ryan Nix now, 52 of 55 on the year in extra points. Perfect 5 for 5 2 weeks ago at Davenport. Sean Boswell is the holder. Now they've got a towel out there to use as kind of a placemat setting for the holder, Boswell, to set up Ryan Nix. High snap, but here's the kick by Nix on the way, and we're in a tie. 7-7, and still just over 11 minutes time remaining this first quarter. New ball game here at Darcy Stadium. We'll step out. This is Cougar Football, Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana.
Half-Den is the official dental provider for USF Athletics. Half-Den has been serving all of Fort Wayne for over 25 years. with patient-friendly dentistry. Visit AppDent for all of your needs.
Welcome back, everybody. Darcy Stadium. Snow now. Light snow has covered the carpet down below. But the flurry of snow has abated somewhat. And just cold, windy. And we'll see how the second possession by Missouri Valley goes. They move methodically downfield. And got a 16-yard touchdown run by Kenny Sanford to grab the early 7-0 lead. But the Cougars responded. And getting a 5-yard Aaron Harris touchdown run off to the right side. And we are tied at 7-7. Again, Devon Henry back deep in kick return. Joined by Stenard. And they'll set up a close... Just inside the 15. Kick coming against Stenard. Wynn caught it. Stenard's got it at the 18. Works left side. Trying to work his way to the middle of the field. Is sandwiched in there and dropped at about the 29-yard line.
Devon Henry on the return.
So first and 10 as Jake Bridges, the young, talented freshman quarterback, came in with over 2,500 passing yards, 26 touchdowns, 6 interceptions, averaging 256.3 yards a ball game.
Missouri Valley will start first and 10 on their own.
So it'll be first and 10 for the Vikings, again moving from left to right out of the north end zone. Two wide to the right side, that's the wide side of the field. Shotgun formation now for Jake Bridges. And looks to hand it off on a sweep coming left side. And here's Sanford as the Cougars contain very well. Lucas Sparks, the Defensive Player of the Year in the Mideast League, limits that gain on the sweep to just about a yard. So it'll be second down and 9. That is one thing the Cougars have really, I thought, improved this year in containment on the sweeps. Second down and 9, empty backfield now. 3 wide to the right, 2 wide to the left. And Bridges, short drop, looking to throw. And throws it left side. Has got a catch and a looping move for a first down. Boy, the Cougars had two out there, but the little move, a little spin move back to the inside, nets a first down as that catch made by Justin Heiser. Heiser with just his 10th catch on the year. But that gets him a first down, now improving field position at the Viking 42-yard line. Moving from left to right. One back look, Sanford flanked off to the right side of Bridges. Low snap, picks it up, and there was whistles right at the snap. And let's see if we're going to have our first penalty of the ball game. David White, our referee today.
Offside, defense number 98 with contact.
It's going to go against St. Francis on encroachment. Cougars coming in averaging just under 72 yards a game in penalties. 2 weeks ago at Davenport had 6 for 55 yards. Missouri Valley penalized 64 yards a game in penalties. Last week had 4 for 27. First and 5 now, improving field position into Cougar territory at the 47. Long count from the line of scrimmage. Too wide to the right. They'll run Sanford off tackle again. He's got running room and is bumped out of bounds. Lee Stewart came up, knocked him out of bounds short of the first down stick.
Pushed out of bounds by number 4, Lee Stewart, the Cougars.
And by the way, that is just short of midfield now. It'll bring up a
Missouri Valley 49
second down and 3 call coming up at the Viking 49-yard line. Just short of midfield. Again, 3 wide to the right side. Shotgun formation for Jake Bridges. A little motion now by Sanford. Out the left side. And Bridges drops, looks to throw. And throws the home run ball. He's got a man out there, and that ball is caught. And it is going to be taken to the end zone. And that was Devon Henry for a touchdown. Devon Henry, good for 49 yards. and a touchdown at the 9:13 mark. By the way, make that 51 yards. So again, it's a big play strike for Missouri Valley, and they're on the board as Bridges to Devon Henry for the go-ahead touchdown. Austin Johnson again comes in now to attempt the extra point. Holder is Jacoby Bellard. Johnson, 39 of 40 on the year, coming in and got plenty of lift in this one, and it is good. So once again, Missouri Valley strikes to take the lead, breaking the 7-7 tie. That'll make it a 14-7 Viking lead with a timeout here at Darcy Stadium. And time in for this word. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana.
National Car Rental, the official automobile rental company of the NAIA. For a higher level of service, call National Car Rental at 1-800-CAR-RENT. Kicking off from Missouri Valley, number 39, Aaron Ball. Team for the Cougars will be number 17, Justin Green.
Cougars again will need to play from behind here in the early going, trailing at 14-7. A combination, I think, of the field conditions. The receivers know where they're going. The defenders do not. And very tough to make cuts from a defensive standpoint. And then the simple fact that this is a talented team with quickness in the receiving core for the Vikings. 14-7, they lead it now. Here comes the kickoff. Let's see if they go to Green. And they do a kick it deep, far side. Green trying to locate it back inside the 10. Takes a look, comes right side, and rakes it to the outside across the 20. Trying to turn the corner, splits defenders, and brought it across the 30-yard line. Propelled the body forward after that first hit. Let's see where they mark him down.
Justin Green on the return.
Officials will bring it back to about the 30. Let's see, about the 30. 33-yard line, I think, is where they're going to set that down. 9:04 remains here in this first quarter, and the Cougar offense comes back on the field, but down 14-7. Aaron Harris will stay in as the running back. And Nick Ferrer brings his team up to the line of scrimmage. Brian Gegner at center, getting ready to snap the ball. Gegner in motion from right to left. They want to throw the ball. And looking for Coat. Coat's got it on his fingertips inside the 20, inside the 15, straight arms of the defender. Still on his tiptoes down the left sidelines. And he got in for a touchdown. One play, 67-yard touchdown toss. The Cougars on the board with a tying touchdown. 67 yards. And Seth Coat with that strength and enough speed to leg it the final yards, tipped down the left sidelines into the end zone at the 8:53 mark. Well, so far, a lot of offense, not much defense. Knicks will come on to try to tie the ball game. A late change personnel-wise. Ricky Williams runs off the field. Got it. In time, off the field. Booming extra point kick is on the way, and that is good. So, a lot of offense. 14-14 tie. 53 still remains in the first quarter. We'll be back here to Darcy Stadium. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Tell you what, Kevin Daly was concerned, would Ferrer have enough arm strength to defeat the wind? He did. Aired it out, and Seth Coat, great focus on the ball. By the way, beginning to lighten up here. And they're going to try to bring out a couple of shovels to deal with some of the accumulation of snow that is pretty much obliterated much of the yard lines here. Ferrer with the touchdown toss. That's his 36th of the year. And Seth Coate with his 15th touchdown catch. And Coate, what can you say about him? What all he's done, the senior, 53rd catch of his season. Did a great job of maintaining focus on that ball. You know, the wind had to be knuckling that ball. Got it, and then fought off a defender in the final 15 yards and tiptoed the final 5 yards into the end zone. 14-14 tie. And Nix with the third kickoff already of this ball game goes far side, and that one takes a high bounce. Devon Henry picks it up inside the 10. Looks to the left side and is behind the defense. He's got one man to beat again, and he cuts to the right side all the way to midfield, and that might have been a touchdown-saving tackle by Ryan Nix. But it'll be very good field position now for the Vikings. First and 10 right at midfield. Well, that ball took a bounce. The wind blew it away from Henry, but it bounced straight up in the air. And then he waited for a hole, and they'll mark it at the USF 49-yard line. Well, so far, no evidence of defense either way. 14-14 tie. Great field position now at the Cougar 49 for the Vikings. And Bridges looking to hand the ball off, and here is Sanford, and wrapped up by Sparks, and he's going to lose yardage. They may mark forward progress to the 50, but it's still a loss of one. And now the nose of the football just a tad on the Missouri Valley side of midfield. David White, a referee wanting to chat with one of his crew. And now Sanford flanks out to the right side. They finally wind the clock. Empty backfield for Bridges now. USF's not been able to get to the young freshman quarterback. Short throw, and he throws good wrap-up by Nashawn Lewis that time. A catch is made to the USF 45. See where they're going to spot that ball.
Dorian Stenard.
Stenard on the catch. And they will mark it right at the USF 45-yard line. It'll be third down, and let's call it six. On third downs, Missouri Valley for the year, 37%. Last week against Mid-American Nazarene, 5 of 10 for 50%. Trying to get to the Cougar 39-yard line on this snap. Bridges drops, hands to Sanford. No, he does throw the ball, and that's a catch. And again, a missed tackle, and they'll have a first down, a little stop and go right side by Stenard. And again, you have got to wrap up. Cannot make arm tackles in Missouri Valley on the move once again in this 14-14 tie. And they'll mark that ball at the USF 27-yard line. First and 10. Cougars now with Christian Johnson. A down three offense at the defensive line right now for USF. And Bridges from the right side hash mark. And keeps the ball himself, spun around. And this time they've got him dropped for a loss. Coming in there, good play by Marcus Stepp. Out of Bishop Goinger High School, two tackles 2 weeks ago, an interception against Davenport, the 225-pound sophomore. And one of the things Kevin Daly was concerned about the young freshman quarterback, a lot of creativity in scramble plays. But that time, Stepp would not let go. And hauls him down for a big loss all the way back to the Cougar 39-yard line. It'll bring up second down and 22. Jacoby Bellard now maneuvering back to the far side. Two wide, spread offense, four. Empty backfield once again. Here's Bridges. Look, steps up, throws late. There's a tip ball incomplete. They were trying to go to Stenard, but good coverage that time by St. Francis. Lee Stewart was converging on the play.
Pass and center for number four, Dorian Stenard, is incomplete. Brings up third down.
Third down and long now for the Vikings. Trying to get down inside the USF 20-yard line. They have a field goal kicker. Austin Johnson, 7-11 this year, long of 41. Last week, I should say, one for one. He's got a long of 42, on the season. Again, they'll work with one back, flanked to the left side of Kenny Bridges, the freshman quarterback. Short drop, pump fake, spins to his left side. Has got room, that throws back near side. Has got a big catch inside the 20-yard line down to about the 17. Little throwback to the right side to Jacoby Bellard, who leads them now. Came in with 53 catches on the day, and it'll bring up. No, they got a first down. First and 10 at the USF 16-yard line.
The Cougars 16-yard line.
Boy, they run great routes, and you just have to be aware and stay at home. Now three wide to the left side, two wide to the right. Empty backfield once again for Bridges. Now maybe changing the play call at the line of scrimmage. Two on the play clock. Let's see if they got the play off. Here's Bridges, throws over the middle, has got a catch, and they've got another touchdown.
Bridges pass complete to number 14, Siobhan.
That is Siobhan Richardson on the deep post pattern. Good for 16 yards and touchdown. And again, Missouri Valley, three possessions, three touchdowns, and they lead the fourth-ranked Cougars 20-14. Time of the score, 5:39. Again, no pressure whatsoever. The Vikings have given up 26 sacks this year, two last week. But St. Francis has not been able to put any pressure on the freshman, Jake Bridges, the quarterback. Now Johnson, high snap, fire play, and a roll to the left side. And they will not get anything out of this. It was picked up by Bellard, but hogtied. So it'll remain a six-point lead for Missouri Valley. 20-14 will keep things right here. The lead is six. And Bridges now has thrown his second touchdown pass of the day. Earlier hit Devon Henry with a 51-yard touchdown. And now to Richardson, good for 16 yards.
Another one of our NAIA sponsors.
Of course, the big play was on that third down and long, third down and 22. They picked it up on the catch, the throwback to Jacoby Bellard. So the Cougars again trying to play from behind, but now down six. 5:39 remaining. As we mentioned earlier, the stadium lights finally got turned on here after the game was started, and right about kickoff time, the snow really developed, blowing snow, and it got very dark here at Darcy Stadium. Lights are on. Justin Green is back deep in kick return. Waits inside the Cougar 10-yard line for the kickoff. Get a bunched lineup either side of the hash mark by Missouri Valley. And here comes the kick, high, end over end. Getting to the right side, and it'll bounce and takes a high bounce. Grabbed now by Justin Green. Works right side, burst of speed across the 25, 30-yard line. And again, cartwheels across the 30 up to about the 34. It's going to depend where they say the knee hit as he went airborne. It'll be a good field position for St. Francis once again, first and 10.
There's a penalty marker on the field.
Apparently a flag was thrown. David White, our referee, coming over to the near sidelines. Trying to engage Coach Kevin Daly with some sort of an explanation or see what options there might be available to St. Francis. Still no decision.
Offside, number 46 of the kicking team. St. Francis has elected to re-kick after the 5-yard penalty.
So it was offsides by Missouri Valley on the kickoff. And Coach Donnelly says, let's make him kick it again, but about 5 yards deeper. 5:34 remaining. Boy, Missouri Valley has not been stymied at all by the St. Francis defense. They got a 16-yard touchdown run by Kenny Sanford to start the ball game. Then a couple of Jeff Bridges touchdown throws, one to Devon Henry, and most recently 16 yards to Siobhan Richardson. to give this a 20-14 Missouri Valley lead. Now they'll back them up, and they'll tee it up at the... I'm not sure that's the right spot, is it? Got to move it back to the 30.
Kick it off from Missouri Valley, 39, Aaron Baum.
Well, Baum will kick it off. Aaron Baum,
the
punter. We have not seen any punts so far in this first quarter. And they'll tee it up at the 30-yard line. Green still waiting back at the 10. Wind has a tendency to blow the ball as we look at it away to the southeast, if you will. Green back there waiting at about the 10 and trying to anticipate where the kick may go. This time they'll spread it out, and we'll see if they do kick deep to Green. Baum ready with the left hand, now approaches with the kickoff. And he does kick it short, though, this time. It'll be fielded up around the 30-yard line. And a run across the 40, 45, and into Missouri Valley territory. Jason Nicodemus, the up back, just bowls his way straight ahead. And that decision by Coach Kevin Donnelly to force the re-kick pays off. It'll be first and 10, USF at the 46-yard line of Missouri Valley. 20-14, Vikings have got the lead. Brian Gagner at center, Zach Minardo and Connor Holcomb, the guards today. Keegan Bruner and Alex Woods are the tackles. They average 281 a man tackle to tackle. USF from the right side hash mark, Kelsaw. And the slot to the near side, they want to throw the ball. Ferrer checks off, now throws deep, looking for Monte McDowell. That ball's underthrown and knocked away. Good defense back there. McDowell was the intended receiver.
Brings up second down and 10.
Good coverage that time as Stephon Seals, a 5'9 senior defensive back, was step for step with McDowell. Seals just 5'9, McDowell at not able to use his height advantage. Now second down and 10, they'll run the ball off tackle. Green looking for running room and runs into tacklers at about the 43-yard line. That'll be a gain of 4. So third down coming up, third down and 7. Tackle made by Stephen Thayer, 5'9 senior. Good player, had 10 tackles last week at Mid-America Nazarene against Mid-American Nazarene, two tackles for loss and one sack. Cougars on third downs, trying to reach the 36 on this snap. And they've got two wide to the right side as Ferrer looks, steps up, throws back near side. There's a catch made at the 30 by Cote again. Little stop and go move and then nudges out of bounds at about the 22-yard line. Covers that time by Juwan Cassidy. But Seth Cote with the second catch of the ball game, and the first one was a big one, good for 67 yards and a touchdown. That at that point tied the game. Right now, though, the Vikings have the six-point advantage. First and 10 at the Viking 22-yard line. Same formation with two wide to the right side. Aaron Harris is the running back, offset a little bit behind to the left. As Ferreira wants to throw again over the middle, has got a man and off the fingertips, incomplete. That was Nicodemus, laid out for the ball, but just could not find the handle, the 5'9 senior. So to bring up second down and 10. Ferreira saw that he had a step running the deep post, skinny post down the middle. But he muscled up on the ball and just off the fingertips as Nicodemus could not catch up to it. Now Rocky James and Nate Carson were checking into the game, but they have to go back with a play clock down to 14. Second down in, channel of the ball at the left side hash mark. Ferrer again, long count from the line of scrimmage. And a little flinch to the right side, but no harm, no foul. Here's a quick throw. Coach got it again, lost the football. Let's see, they're going to rule that no catch. Never had possession. Seth Cote in the cold. Now, you won't see many drops by Seth Cote, but that time got hit by a couple of defenders either side, and the ball immediately squirted free. It'll come back to the 23-yard line, 22-yard line now, and third down and 10. Cougars were 6 of 14 2 weeks ago at Davenport for 43%. For the year, they had 46% on third down conversions. That's 10th best among all NAIA football teams. Needing 10 yards now, Ferrer with Coat split wide to the short side to the left. Looks again. Now steps up, throws a little, has got an open grab. That's a nice catch by Akeem Kelsaw. Inside the 10, down close to the 7. That ball was high and a little bit behind Kelsaw. Reached up and grabbed it and falls down. They'll spot it first and goal at the 8-yard line. So the Cougars trying to take their first lead of the ball game. They've twice trailed by 7, trailing by 6 right now. On the missed extra point attempt by Missouri Valley. McDowell splits wide to the right side once again. Now P.J. Dean checks into the backfield as the running back. And motion right to left. And they'll give to Dean. Dean trying to test the middle. And reaches about the 5.
P.J. Dean, the ball carrier.
Clock now moving inside 3.5 minutes. Time remaining in this first quarter. We have an officials timeout by referee David White as we have a player down for Missouri Valley. Looks like one of the big boys down on his stomach and not moving right now. So we are going to have an injury timeout here at Darcy Stadium. 20-14 our score. And let's see. That is the big nose guard, Kyerton Kilgore, 6'1 junior, 305 pounds, out of St. Louis. Had 2 tackles last week, 4.5 sacks coming into today's ball game, 8.5 tackles for loss. He's trying to get up a little bit and now on his feet, being assisted. His replacement is Steven Middendorf, who's a 267-pound sophomore. A lot of young folks on this Missouri Valley team. Vikings with 4 freshmen and 2 sophomores starting on offense, and 1 freshman and 1 sophomore on defense. So second down and goal at the 5. Ball, nose of the football just outside the 5-yard line for USF. Justin Green now comes back in the ball game as the running back. Zach Gegner up on the wing to the left side. Slot right is Akeem Kelsaw. Split wide of him, Monte McDowell. Ferreira out of the pistol once again. Looks, stretch handoff, gives to Green. Looking for running room, and he dances into the end zone. Off tackle run from 5 yards out. Justin Green, first of the day, his 6th rushing touchdown of the season. 2 weeks ago, had 14 carries for 84 yards against the Davenport Panthers. So Justin Green into the end zone at the 3:16 mark. And now Ryan Nix comes on trying to give St. Francis its first lead of the day. Sean Boswell, the holder. And here is the snap. Right-footed kick is long enough, and it is good. And St. Francis, for the first time today, with 3:16 remaining here in the opening quarter, on top of visiting Missouri Valley, 21-20. And we have a timeout. We'll be back with more coverage of Cougar football right here on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. With the lead for the first time today, 21-20 over the 12th-ranked Missouri Valley College Vikings. I'm Joe Parson. Glad you could join us here today. We have seen it all so far. Now the snow has tapered off to just a few light flurries, lightening up as well. 37 degrees at kickoff, snow showers, wind pretty much steady at 23 miles an hour, the occasional gust, they tell us, over 40 miles an hour, and wind chill in the mid-20s. Football weather. Well, we kind of set the stage. The first team that could find some defensive abilities might have a good chance to win this ball game. So far, defense has been pretty much conspicuously lacking by both teams. Nick's ready to kick it away from right to left once again. Gets the go-ahead, approaches, and kicked it. The wind caught it a little bit, and that'll be fielded at the 15-yard line. Henry working to the left side, looking to get to turn the corner, and is angled out of bounds across the 30 to about the 31. That is where the Vikings get ready to go back to work offensively. Jeff Bridges completing 63% of his passes coming into today's ball game. Started the day with 26 touchdowns. He's added two more already today. 3:10 remains in the first quarter. And Bridges will bring his offensive unit out onto the field now, working from left to right. Siobhan Richardson's caught a touchdown. They'll run the play action fake and a throw over the middle. Here's a diving attempt for the ball. Let's see how they're going to rule it. And they call it a catch. And that's a catch right over the middle.
Bridges pass complete to number 35, Cody Hendricks.
Cody Hendricks, who is a tight end, 238-pound senior. Went down to the turf, got his hands under the ball, they rule. And it's first and 10, Missouri Valley just short of midfield. Here is Sanford trying to feel his way off the left side. He's not going to get around Lucas Sparks. Sanford wrapped up. And Sparks, the defensive player of the year in the Mideast League, brings him down for a yard loss. Now, here is where Missouri Valley is very adept and very good. They'll give you an influence look, similar situation. Roll to the left. They'll throw back to the right, to the backside. And St. Francis has got to stay at home and be aware. Sanford, play clock is down to 17. Sanford steps up as the one back. Pistol alignment, Bridges drops the throw again. Screens the ball left side. Sanford tripped up and knocked down. See if that was Nashawn Lewis that just got enough of him to knock him off his pins and limit to a, well, it'll bring up third down and 9. Cougars making a late personnel switch. Carlin Coleman will check in now. And Christian Johnson leaves the ball game. So third down and 9. They've got to get to the USF 43-yard line. Cougars looking for their first stop of the ball game. Empty backfield now. Three back deep for the Cougars defensively. Here's the drop by Bridges. Looks, throws to the left side. Has got an interception. Cougars have got the ball. Jumping the route, and they'll have their first pick of the day. And that was Lewis, Nashawn Lewis, with the interception. For a moment, it looked like that was going to be a catch. But Lewis got enough of the hands in front and just ripped the ball away from the intended receiver. And the Cougars have the first turnover of the ball game as they'll take over with 1:29 remaining in the quarter, leading it by one. They'll have first and 10 at the Missouri Valley 39-yard line. Lewis, that's his third interception of the year. Cougars, their 13th as a team. And Ferrer now with excellent field position. Looks and spins. Looks, wants to throw of the middle. He's got a high ball that's caught. That's usually Boswell, and this Sean Boswell. Sets down over the middle. And he's got a catch inside the 25 to the 24-yard line. Sean Boswell with his 23rd catch of the year. Had one catch for 24 yards 2 weeks ago at Davenport.
And the result of that play is a Glenbrook Chrysler Jeep.
Boswell stays in, up on the wing to the right side. Split wide of him will be McDowell. Other than that, a tight formation for St. Francis. Little motion now back right to left. Here is Ferrer, does hand the ball off, looking for running room. That's Boswell, steps out of one tackle and angles left side down to about the 18, maybe the 17-yard line. Ricky Williams came across and got him by the ankle.
Play by number 32, Jake King.
Jake King also there. It'll be a gain of 7. And they'll spot it at the 17-yard line. Final 37 seconds of the quarter. Cougars trying to extend what is a tenuous one-point lead. P.J. Dean in as the running back in the one-back position. Gagner a little motion left to right. Here's the stretch handoff, and King, or P.J. Dean, breaks tackles, works inside the 10 to the 5, and he's into the end zone. Did he step out of bounds? We're waiting for the indication. He's out of bounds inside the 5 at around the 2, maybe the 1. Let's see where they mark it. Cougars are celebrating like they've got a touchdown. P.J. Dean trying to reach out, I believe. And they're going to rule him. He stepped out of bounds at the 1. So it'll be first and goal. Gegner leaves the ball game now. And meanwhile, they're going to let the time of final seconds expire. So we will have completed the first 15 minutes here at Darcy Stadium. A lot of offense, not much defense, but the Nashawn Lewis interception has given the Cougars a chance to extend their one-point lead going into the second quarter. 21-20 our score. This is Cougar football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Robert, did I miss a spot? Tri-State? Okay. Joe Parson with you on a sunny, well, not sunny, snowy afternoon here at college football in Fort Wayne. What a change from 24 hours earlier. Had some windy but warm conditions in Fort Wayne and all across the Midwest. But a big drop in the weather. By the way, congratulations to Concordia Lutheran High School football team. They will play for a state championship in 3A next Saturday afternoon down at Lucas Oil Stadium. Cougars now ready to go to work. First and goal from the 1 yard line. Ferrer under center, looks to Dean. Dean will just walk into the end zone off the right side. So 1 yard touchdown run, first play, first snap to begin the second quarter, and the Cougars now up by 7. P.J. Dean getting into the end zone, his third rushing touchdown of the season. Nick so far today, perfect on conversions, trying to give the Cougars a lead of 8. Snow beginning to come down a little heavier now, and also getting darker here at Darcy Stadium. Here's a fire play now as a low snap that's picked up, and that will leave it a 27-20 ball game. So the Cougars, with the wind and the cold affecting the snap.
There's no good making the score.
So St. Francis will have to be content to lead it 27-20 now. And we'll keep things right here. Let's take a look at some of the numbers, these respective teams. Cougars came in averaging 40 points a ball game. Exactly. That was second best in the MSFA behind Marion. Number 9 nationally. Vikings were averaging 30.7 points a ball game. And defensively, the Cougars giving up 16.1, again, second to Marion in the MSFA. Number 8 nationally. Check it. Cougars were number 5 nationally. Missouri Valley giving up only 17 points a ball game, and right behind the Cougars nationally at number 6. Well, let's see now. Cougar, the teams having exchanged ends. Devon Henry back deep again. And Bellard, where is he? Usually been working with a couple of kick returners. Charles Gaston out there on the special teams kickoff unit. 27-20. USF. Knicks now getting ready to kick it away from left to right. And here we go. Kickoff down the middle, high, end over end. Henry comes up to it at the 12. Starts right, cuts back to the left side, middle of the field, and chopped down right at the 30-yard line. So first and 10, Vikings now working from right to left, and we'll see if this change of field position changes the ability to throw the ball for Jeff Bridges. The quarterback was picked off, his seventh interception of the year by Nashawn Lewis that has given the Cougars a chance to lead at 27-20. Some of the first quarter numbers, Bridges 10 of 12 in that first quarter for 191 yards, two touchdowns. And the lone interception, Ferrer was 5 of 8 for 124, one touchdown. Waiting for this first snap for the Vikings now, working from right to left. Bridges steps away, and 12 on the play clock. Kenny Sanford, the running back, and they'll hand the ball to him off. Tackle run to the left side, pinching in. He'll reach the 35, 36-yard line.
Kenny Sanford, the ball carrier.
Coward came back, pinched in. Pearson Harnish was there as well.
Tackling a play by number 30, Spencer Cowherd, and number 9, Pearson Harnish of the Cougars.
Nashawn Lewis, talking to the head linesman, felt that he might have been impeded. That'll be a gain of 8. Good run by Sanford. Came in with over 1,000 yards rushing on the year. He's flanked to the right side. Quick spin move to the right side. Bridges throws on the run. Has got a catch. That's Justin Heiser. And let's see, they're going to mark him with a first down catch across the 40 to the 41. Cougars were right there defensively. And again, Bridges not intimidated by the change of field positions.
The play is a first down.
Kind of a jump pass by the, he's not all that big, just a freshman at 5'9". But does not play like a freshman. So improving field position now for the Vikings at their own 42-yard line, first and 10. Bridges checks off again, looks to Kenny Sanford, his running back, flanked to his left. Now takes the snap, little option run, and Sparks has got him wrapped up and dropped. Sparks stayed right with the shifty Jake Bridges and brought him down for a loss back inside the 40 to the 37. Loss of 3. Well, the other playoff game involving Mid-States Football Association teams, that starts down in Indianapolis just in about 10 or 15 minutes. Pits the undefeated Marion Knights hosting the Robert Morris Eagles. Eagles at 7-3. Second down and 13 from the 38-yard line. Here's a drop ball by Bridges. Picks it up and is warped and swarmed and dropped. Sparks was in there again, but he had company. Pearson Harnish was on the move, and that's a loss back inside the 30 to the 29. Now, Lucas Sparks, you've heard his name not just today, but all season long. 7 tackles, a half for loss 2 weeks ago at Davenport. 15 tackles for loss when the day started. 11 sacks that led the Cougars in that category. And again, a big loss. They've got to get to the USF 48 on this third down call. Sanford now will split wide to the left, so an empty backfield for Bridges. Got to be alert with those undercover areas. Here's Bridges. Short drop. Looks. Now steps up. Gets away from one. Little stop and go move. Rolling to the right side. Throws it in a short hop ball. Could not really square up to put anything into that throw. So we will see our first punt of the ball game. And Merry Christmas. The snowflakes, big and numerous, falling here at Darcy Stadium. So Aaron Baum in to punt for the first time today. Had 3 punts last week. Had a long of 35. Averaged 33 yards a punt. Sean Boswell back in punt return at the Cougar 40-yard line. And here's a high wobbly ball. He got the kick away. That's a short wobbly ball. It'll hit at midfield. Takes a Viking roll upfield down inside the 45 to about the 43-yard line. That is where St. Francis, leading at 27-20, will go back to work offensively now. 12:08 remaining in this first half. Looking at some of those other first quarter numbers, as far as rushing, Sanford with six carries for net 23 yards. St. Francis, Justin Green, three carries for 48 yards, had a rushing touchdown. P.J. Dean, two carries for 19 yards. Aaron Harris, three for 13 and a touchdown. And Nicodemus, one carry for 3 yards. Coat with two catches, 88 yards, a touchdown. And Devon Henry, three catches, 75 yards and a touchdown. Here's an off-tackle run to the left side. That's a gain out to about
Justin
the 45.
Tackle on the play by Jake King.
Justin Green got the call. Again, they'll mark that ball just across the 45.
And a three brings up
so call it a pickup of three, second down and seven. Ball is at the St. Francis 46-yard line. Coat in wide to the far side. Two wide to the right. Shotgun formation now for Nick Ferrer. Ferrer takes the snap again. Short drop. Looks to Coat, and then he's got the catch and spins to the outside. Picks up the first down as he stepped out of bounds at the Viking 46. So the Cougars move the chains. Clock stopped with 11:26 remaining. Well, we had 41 combined points in the first quarter. And three times the Cougars trailed to Missouri Valley at the start of this ball game. Now it's 27-20 USF with that number four ranking. Working from left to right. Here's Green, steps up and then dropped. Got back to the line of scrimmage and that is it. Little adjustment defensively that time by Missouri Valley. And Stephen Thayer was there. Came in with 102 tackles on the year, 19 and a half tackles for loss, 9 sacks, and 2 fumble recoveries.
From the Missouri Valley 46-yard line.
So it'll bring up second down and 10. Ball marked at the just outside the Viking 46-yard line at the left side hash mark. Here's a quick screen coming far side. And let's see if that's Gegner. I believe it is Zach Gegner.
Pass complete to number 87, Zach Gegner.
Well, Gegner, you don't a lot of times see him split to the as a wideout. Usually a motion back or on the wing. Use him a lot for blocking purposes, but able to make the catch. Tiptoes down the far sideline to the Viking 41-yard line. Third down and 5. St. Francis trying to reach the 36-yard line on this snap. Cougars were 3 of 3 on third down occasions in the first quarter. Ferrer looking near side, muscles up, and that it. Let's see if they roll the catch. Kelso again, difficult catch, falling down. The ball was delivered low and to his left. Had to virtually fall backwards, caught the ball and wrapped up. And again, the second great catch by Akeem Kelso here today. Game very memorable, especially for seniors both ways. Back in your minds, you know it could be your final collegiate football game. First and 10, USF on the move once again. Inside of 10 minutes, now here comes a safety blitz coming up. As Ferreira, they pick that up, looks, pump, fake. Now throws right side, looking for McDowell, but that one sailed wide and high over everybody.
Monte McDowell.
Coverage back there by Seals. Seals at 5'9". McDowell kind of held up on the pattern. On the pump and go. And the ball sailed harmlessly in the right corner of the end zone. Nate Carson was in for a play, now leaves. Gegner stays in. He'll set up on the left wing. Rocky James. Part of the Twins package here to the near side. Joined also by Kelso. One back look with Green. And the look to Green. Green looking for running room. Checks, and that, by the way, that's Aaron Harris. Harris off tackle run. Doesn't get a lot.
Aaron Harris, the ball carrier.
So it'll bring up third down. They rule it no gain. Third down and 10.
No gain brings up third down and 10.
Again, the ball at the 34-yard line. Well, maybe about a half a yard. Let's call it third down and 9 for St. Francis. At the 34. Down the snow abating once again. Kelso in the slot to the left side. Split wide of him will be Coat. They're playing well off of Seth Coat by about 12, 15 yards. Here's Ferrer, looks near side, throws, there's Rocky James, and the ball stripped away but ruled incomplete. Had it initially, but then Seals with the coverage, knocked away, and it'll bring up fourth down. McDowell will come back in for Rocky James. That time, Ferrer had James in his mind all the way. Code and Kelsaw to the left side as the Cougars work from the right side hash mark now. Gegner trying to plant his feet, get some grip off this freezing turf. Here's Ferrer, throws near side again, and the ball is caught. That's McDowell, and bumped out of bounds. And boy, the big fella, nice job sandwiched in between defenders. Caught the ball and picked up a couple of extra yards after the catch and picks up a valuable first down as well. So the fourth down bid succeeds for St. Francis. And they'll have it first and 10 at the 17-yard line of Missouri Valley. 27-20, USF. Three times trailed in the first quarter. Battled back for a 21-20 lead. Now it's 27-20. And here is P.J. Dean. Starts left, cuts back to the right side. Gets by one at the 15 to the 10. Angles to the pylon, but stepped out of bounds inside the 5. Right at the 5 is where they say stepped out of bounds. Good job by P.J. Dean on that run. A play that was designed to go off the left side. No hole was available. So good reaction by P.J. Dean, the 5'11", 187-pound sophomore running back. Nicodemus now out there, and they'll keep P.J. Dean in there. They basically line up in tandem off the left wing's position. Ferrer out of the pistol, now looking, and looks, and did hand the ball off, and Kelso in a foot race, and he will score! It'll be ruled a pass. So that's a Ferrer little touch pass on Kelso coming back from right to left on motion. And the Cougars add to their 7-point lead at the 8-11 mark. Ferrer does such a good job of disguising that, like he's going to throw. If he's going to throw, it'll be back to the right. And Akeem Kelso, who's made a couple of great catches here today. That one probably the shortest pass that he'll receive in his career, but the 6-foot senior gets the touchdown to make it 33-20, and now Nix. Last time the snap evaded Boswell. They come up and there was contact. Let's see how they're going to rule this one. Looked like that was initiated by Missouri Valley. David White, a referee. They going to call that encroachment? Boy, Cougar coaching staff not happy about that call. No, now they change it.
So take it half the distance. Offside, defense number 32 with contact. Half the distance, the penalty will be declined. We'll play the try.
Jake King came across. So it's half the distance to the goal. That will be enforced. And Nick still on to attempt the extra point. A lead of 13 right now. Boswell the hold. Waiting for the snap. Here it comes. Right-footed kick is on the way. And that one is good. So 34-20. We've got 54 combined points by the two teams here in the first half. And the Cougars extend their lead out to 14. 34-20, our score. We'll be back here to Darcy Stadium. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Okay, I think I missed a spot. I must have missed that Tri-State. Not a problem. Okay. And I've got a live read. I see that. I'll get that coming up. Okay, buddy. Well, it's not been easy here today. The Cougars have tightened up a little bit defensively. They've had the Nishawn Lewis interception that has allowed them to now score two more touchdowns. And from a 21-20 lead, they have extended out to a new full 14-point lead. And Missouri Valley has not scored now since the 5:39 mark of the first quarter. Richardson will drop back with Devon Henry into kick return formation. They'll wait at the 15-yard line. Here comes Nix approaching. Kicks took a little off the ball near side. That'll be fielded at the 16 by Henry. Crosses right side looking for some blocks. Now looking to cut back and spun around, and he will be dropped at about the 22-yard line. Cougars a pretty good job that time of circling up and not enabling Devon Henry, very elusive kick returner, very shifty, but that time no options, nowhere to go. Want to look at some of the first quarter defensive numbers. Lucas Sparks with three tackles. Lee Stewart also had three. Wilmer Cole and Nashawn Lewis with two each. Of course, Lewis maybe with one of the biggest plays of the game so far, that interception that has now turned into a 34-20 St. Francis lead. Antoine Palmer with three tackles leading the way for Mo Valley. Here's the throw to the right side. Catch is made. And that's Eric Denton out there, had the coverage. Short, be a short gain of about 3-4 yards. Sanford coming out of the backfield. One thing that the Vikings do, they do move the ball around. They throw to everybody. Sanford came in with 18 catches, 268 yards, and six receiving touchdowns. He picks up three, second down and seven. Four wide to the near side. Empty backfield for Bridges. Bridges looks, throws right side. He's got a man wide up. That ball was nearly picked off. In and out of the hands. Wilmer Cole, it hit him on the top of the shoulder pads and bounced high away. They had a man wide open. I believe that was Richardson out there. That ball was underthrown, and Wilmer Cole played it well. He was not playing the man. He was playing the ball. Third down and seven. Vikings were 2 of 3 on third down conversion opportunities in the first quarter. They've got to reach their own 32-yard line. And the Cougars dropping three deep into coverage. As empty backfield again, Bridges pump fake, wheels to his left side. He can run, takes a look, and boy, it works back to the right side. Got a lot of green to work with. Dutton will push him out of bounds. Let's see if he got to the first down stick. I think he's short.
Keeper pushed out of bounds by number 39.
Right around the 30-yard line, had to get to the 32. Looks like they're going to be about 2 yards short with 7:10 remaining in the half. St. Francis won the toss, deferred. They'll get the ball. And let's see if they're going to bring the punt team on. They will. Aaron Baum will trot onto the field. Well, 2 weeks ago at Baker, Vikings trailed 24-7 against the second-ranked Baker and came back to take the lead late, only to see Baker, I think they're the Wildcats, score a touchdown with under a minute remaining to come back and win that ball game. Low snap, Baum rushes on, short kick high, end over end. That one will hit at the 43, takes a sideways bounce, and then back to the 45. So St. Francis with very good field position at the Cougar 45-yard line. They'll go on offense now with 6:38 remaining in this first half, up 14 points on Missouri Valley.
They'll start first and 10.
Now, the Cougars have adjusted a lot defensively from what we saw the first basically 10 minutes of the ball game when they gave up three touchdowns to the Vikings. Aaron Harris now checks in as the running back in the one back position. Gegner, and by the way, there's enough heat apparently down on the field that the snow is virtually gone away. A lot of green now is Harris. Up the middle, straight run, works the midfield and plows over a defender as he reaches down to about the 48, 47-yard line. They'll spot that ball right at the Viking 47. Tough run by Aaron Harris, who came in with 405 rushing yards. 10 rushing touchdowns. He scored already one today to add to that total. Picks up 6 yards here. Boswell in the slot to the left side. Split wide of him will be Coat, but they'll run the ball again. That time Harris fighting for the first down stick. Did not get there.
Aaron Harris on the carry.
2 yards short. He'll pick up a yard to the 46.
Number 44, Carrington Kilgore.
Carton Kilgore, who was injured early in the ball game, back in there, the big 305-pound nose tackle.
The Viking 46-yard line.
Kept him from picking up that first down. They've got to get to the 44-yard line now on this third down call. Approaching 5.5 minutes time remaining here. All again. Now looking. Cougars again with that clock. They huddle up now, come up to the line of scrimmage. Still 15 on the play clock. Looks like Nate Carson in wide to the short side to the left. Rocky James split wide to the right. Ferrer looking to hand the ball. Green starts left, cuts back right. A little stop and go move. Cuts to the 20, 15. He splits defender. He's going to score, but there's a penalty flag thrown. Let's see if that's going to stand up. Looking in the direction of Akeem Kelsaw. Right now it would be a 21-yard touchdown run by Justin Green. But hold on. We'll wait for the decision on the penalty flag. It'll look so effectively with Wynn Airborne shifted the ball to his left hand and reached just inside the pylon for the effectively, let's call it a 19-yard touchdown toss from Ferrer. There have been a lot of highlight moments for Seth Coate. That will be another one added to his illustrious career. 19 yards unofficially on the touchdown. And Ferrer to Seth Coate, second time. They hooked up earlier for 67 yards. Boswell waiting for the snap. He's got it. The kick looks long enough, and it is good. And St. Francis on the board again. They lead it by 3 touchdowns here at home, 41-20. Still better than 4 minutes remaining in this first half. We'll check out. And this is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana.
But I'm piped up. See that boy right up? He piped up. See that girl right up? She piped up. Pipe it up.
Back at Darcy Stadium, Joe Parson with you on this snowy and chilly Saturday afternoon of playoff football. And the Cougars, who were in a real dogfight with Missouri Valley, now have grabbed a 21-point lead, 41-20. And they have really done a better job defensively at shutting down this potent Viking offense. At least correct at the time of printing right now. St. Francis from leading 21-20 now. They've scored the game's last 27 points, actually from trailing 20-14. Again, we see some blue skies, so we've seen it all here today at Darcy Stadium. Times almost blizzard-like conditions. Heavy wind. Now the ball blows off the tee once again. That part has not changed, will not change. Gust still predicted up 40 miles an hour. Cougars want to bring in Holder now on this kick. That'll be Ryan Johnson that will tend and hold the ball in place for Knicks to kick it away. Three back in kick return. Kick down the middle, end over end, and that over the shoulder catch. That's taken by Richardson at the goal line. Starts back to the right side and gets across the 10, and then he is leveled. Did not reach the 15.
Number 4, Dorian Stenard on the return.
Now check it. It was Stenard on the kick return.
Malachi Mannion and number 43, Vito Capea, the Cougars.
So now the Vikings go to work offensively. They're 4:05 remaining here in the first half. And the worst starting position they've had today. First and 10 at their own 13-yard line. Moving from right to left.
The Vikings will start first and 10 on their own 13-yard line.
Three wide to the left side. Justin Heiser in the middle of the trips package. You have a running back in there. Sanford has done the running. High snap, but they'll give the ball Sanford. Off tackle run to the right side. Steps out of a tackle at the 20, still on his feet, and gets a couple of more yards up to the 22.
Number 10, Kenny
Cougars
Sanford
could not bring him down. Again, a lot of little guys on this Missouri Valley team. And Kevin Daly said it's just real difficult to find them at times. That'll be a gain of 8. And they'll spot the ball just across the 20 to the just short of the 21-yard line.
Brings up second down and 2 from Missouri Valley.
Bridges again out of the shotgun formation. Sanford flanked to his left a little bit behind. Bridges now comes up with 11 seconds on the play clock. High snap, looks, and does give the Sanford. Starts right and comes back to the left and nailed at the 17. He's going to lose yardage. Play designed to go to the right side. There was nothing there.
Brought down on the play by number 98, Eric Hummelgarn.
Hummelgarn was in there, 6'5", sophomore.
And number 30,
Kevin Daly talking to me before the game. He just said, Hummelgarn is just a force. Sparks, Hummelgarn, and Blake Blaker out there right now defensively for the three-down linemen. Third down and 4. Inside of 3 minutes, time remaining. 3 wide to the left. Bridges has the snap again. Looks to the right side. Flank to his right. Now is going to run. Being chased by Pearson Harnish. He's got the first down. Pearson laid out, trying to reach with the left hand, but just could not find him. So the scramble by Jake Bridges, and that's what Kevin Daly says this little guy does. Has a lot of his productivity off of scramble plays. That time able to bring the ball across the 25 to the 28-yard line and a new set of downs for the Vikings to work with.
First and 10 on the 28-yard line of Missouri Valley.
Stannard in, and they'll have 2 wide to the left side. And here's Bridges again looking to hand the ball off to Sanford. Sanford trying to feel his weight and angles across the 30 to the 32.
Number 10, Kenny Sanford on the carry.
Marcus Stepp trying to fight his way through there to get an angle on Sanford. Couldn't get the job done. And that's a gain of 4 for Missouri Valley. Second down and 6. Jacoby Bellard, he's going to leave the ball game. Walks a little bit gingerly. He'll be replaced by Justin Heiser. Both teams with their full complement of 3 timeouts remaining. We're inside of 2 minutes left in this first half. Bridges again. He's got 2 wide to the left side. Angles this side. Now it pulls the ball down and it's going to go down. He saw nothing but blue shirts, including Eric Denton, bearing down on him and takes the dive right at the 29.
Bridges sacked by number 39, Eric Denton. And number 31, Marcus Stepp of the Cougars.
Cougars now bring Carlin Coleman back in defensively. Christian Johnson out there with Hummelgarn.
Brings up 3rd down and 9 from the Viking.
Vikings trying to reach their own 38-yard line on this snap. Clock runs to 1:15, still moving now. Sparks at right defensive end. He's had a big day already in the first half. And here is the shotgun formation again. Bridges looks, steps up on the pockets, got running room now. Runs and tripped up, got to the 35, that's short. Well, they're going to give him a good spot of the ball at the 36. Still is going to be about 2.5 yards short of the first down stick.
And brings up 4th down.
Clock is stopped. Let's see if St. Francis did take the timeout. And we will keep things right here. With still 58.9 seconds remaining in this first half, and want to remind everybody, historic St. Felix Catholic Center now open for retreats. They are located in Huntington, Indiana. That's on 30 scenic acres with plenty of recreational areas and a serene Blessed Mother Grotto. St. Felix Catholic Center is the perfect location for a single day of prayer and overnight retreats. Former home of the venerable Solanus Casey, come visit today. Plan your visit, and you can go to their website at sfcatholiccenter.com. That's sfcatholiccenter.com. Well, the Cougars still hungry for more points. They will have 2 timeouts remaining. A Well, again, you know, when you're preparing for your opponent, you see a lot of film. And we talked about that loss by Missouri Valley 2 weeks ago to Baker. They were down 24-7 and came back to lead in the fourth quarter, only to see Baker score a touchdown in the final minute to win it.
Missouri Valley 39, Aaron Baum.
Baum in to punt the ball away. For the year, he's had a long of 61 yards, averaging 37.8. He waits at his own 21. And now they shift back at, well, they're going to have maybe a short snap. Let's see if there's some trickery coming up. Low snap. Baum does get the kick away. Low end-over-end kick. Hits into Cougar territory. That field up by Boswell. Steps out of a tackle, and he's back to midfield. Tell you what, Boswell took a chance, as that was a tricky punt. He picked it up on the second short hop and brought it straight ahead. And they will mark it. Now they're going to move it back to the Cougar 47-yard line with 49.8 seconds remaining. So the Cougars, let's see if they have a one-minute drill in mind right now. Cougar offense walking out on the field with this 41-20 lead. Ball is going to be marked right at midfield, first and 10. And here's Ferrer out of the pistol. Two wide either side. Screens the ball. Kelsaw with a block at the 45, 40, and angles out of bounds to the 36-yard line. Well, even trying to position perhaps Ryan Nix for a field goal, 4 of 7 this year in field goal attempts. He has had a long of 35 yards, has had one blocked. Haven't seen a field goal in a while. Reminds us of the old days where Kevin Donnelly disdained field goals, regardless of the situation. It'll be first and 10. Here's Ferrer, time of the pocket. Checks off, now throws over the middle. He's got Kelsaw again with a, that's at McDowell at the 25. McDowell brought down right immediately. He'll have a first down. The clock stops with 36.8 seconds remaining. And the Cougars may take another timeout. They will take a timeout. They'll have one left. And we will step out as well. 41-20 our score. Timeout down below. This is Cougar Football and Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Robert, you might need some filler spots today. Cougars with the ball at the 24-yard line of the Vikings now, trying to extend what is a 21-point lead at 41-20. Cougar offense comes back onto the field now. McDowell stays in, split wide to the right, the short side. Now Gigner, motion to the left, creating a trips package. Here is Ferrer looking, can't find anybody. Flush to his right, still looking. He is going to run the ball and takes it down to about the 21-yard line. Clock is down to 29.4. That'll be a gain, a run for Ferrer of about the 4 yards. They'll spot the ball right at the 20-yard line.
Gain of 4 brings up second and 6.
Second down, 6 yards to go. Two safeties back right now for the Vikings, and they're going to drop also one of the linebackers, Thayer, back there deep as well. From the right side hash mark, Ferrer looking, wants to throw again. Loads up, and that's a, well, let's see. McDowell came up with it, but did not. Well, boy, there's some extracurriculars going on.
82, Monte McDowell is
as Bruner was leveled well after the play.
Brings up third down and 6.
Boy,
from the Viking 20-yard line.
Tell you what, is that Kevin Donnelly out on the field? That he was motioning to David White, the referee, but he was occupied with his vision elsewhere and didn't see that. But that was a, should have been a penalty. P.J. Dean now comes in. It'll be third down and 6. Kelsaw has got a touchdown today. Seth Coat. He's wide to the left. Motion back to the right side. Here is Ferrer. Looks, and the ball tipped, and that's going to be dropped. So to bring up fourth down, and once again, Boy, I tell you what, David White is just not paying any attention.
Pass intended for 82, Monte McDowell is incomplete and brings up fourth down.
As Bruner was knocked down. Again, I think that's Aguilar who knocked him down. That's the second time they've had those plays. One of the other Cougar linemen was trying to get David White's attention. That's coming well after the whistle. But now it's fourth down. The Cougars will try to pick up the first down with 19.4 seconds remaining. No field goal attempt coming up. Pistol lineman once again, and now what we have? We have a timeout by the Vikings. So we'll keep things right here in this 41-20 ball game. Missouri Valley wants to make sure to set their defense as the Cougars will try to get right down to about the 14-yard line, I believe, on this fourth down play coming up.
Well,
mentioned a lot of points in this ball game. 41 combined in the first quarter, and now 61 combined in this first half. Cougars, as far as big days scoring-wise, they had a 58-14 victory back in early September at Olivet Nazarene. Then against Lincoln, Lindenwood Belleville on September the 24th here, 63 points in the 63-7 win. And who would have guessed they would have a big lead now, 41-20, as this Viking team had the three touchdowns and three possessions to start the ball game. Ferreira, short drop again. Looks, throws the left side. That's Coat. He's got the catch inside the 10. Gave some ground and takes two of them to bring him down at the 9. Ten and a half seconds remaining. Cougars with one timeout remaining. Time for maybe a couple of plays. They'll have it first and goal. And they'll mark it at the 10-yard line.
And that results in a Glenwood Chrysler Jeep.
And the Cougars are going to take that final timeout, I believe, right now.
Timeout on the field. Timeout, St. Francis.
That is their final timeout. So Kevin Daly wants to talk to his team about at least one, maybe two options. And depending how quick, perhaps even three options before halftime. But St. Francis really settled down after the first early success by Missouri Valley on their first three possessions. There really was no defense present on either side of the field. And the Cougars have basically adjusted since falling behind at 20-14. And it's been a different looking St. Francis defense, and also the offense has come alive with 41 first half points so far. You always look at turnover margin, but especially playoff teams, and neither of these teams has done well. Missouri Valley, -2 for the year. That's because they came into that game last week even, and they were -2 last week, even though they won against Mid-America Nazarene. Cougars now first and goal at the 9. They'll work from the left side hash mark. Here is Ferrer. Wants to throw. Looks, pulls it down. Now throws deep, and that's incomplete. Seth Coat at 6'3", tried to go up and got right hand on the ball. But even at 6'3", could not pull that one in. Incomplete, takes the clock down to 6 seconds. Juwan Cassidy at 5'11", had the coverage. Cougars will bring, well, they're going to bring out Nix now to attempt the field goal. Now they bring that unit back. And I think Kevin Daly just wants to talk to Ferrer, and I think the decision has been made. We'll give it one more shot. Hopefully they'll be, if we don't get a touchdown, have time for Nix to come on to attempt the field goal. Play clock is down to 4, down to 3. Here's Ferrer. Looks, throws quickly. There's Coat, and that one hit Cassidy. That was a quick release with 2.8 seconds remaining, and now the field goal team will come out to try to make it a 44-20 lead here at halftime. Well, we haven't seen Nix with field goal attempts in recent weeks. 4 of 7 on the year. This one will be from about 26 yards out, 27 yards out. He is 3 of 4 inside of 29 yards. From the left side hash mark, Boswell is the hold. And from 27 yards out, field goal, it's long enough. Let's see if it is good. And it is. 27-yard field goal by Ryan Nix will take us to halftime. And the Cougars will have a 44-20 lead here over the 12th-ranked Missouri Valley College Vikings. And we'll be back with our halftime coverage and recap all the scoring. And that's going to take a while. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana.
Fans, today the USF Marching Pride presents an encore performance of our marvelous music show that will be highlighting music selections from films featuring superheroes from Marvel Comics. We begin with an arrangement of an Aerosmith cover of a tune featured both in television and on the big screen. Please enjoy the theme from Spider-Man.
Well, we've seen it all here at Darcy Stadium, and a lot of snow at times, and partially obliterating the yard lines and the down markers here at Darcy Stadium. And then at times we'd see a little bit of blue sky, but one constant has been the wind, and it has been ferocious here today, averaging about 22, 23 miles an hour with gusts up to 40 out of the west-northwest, and a 37-degree actual temperature at kickoff, but wind chill at the mid-20s, about 25 degrees, and it is at times it has really affected the play down below. But St. Francis finally rallying and shored up its defense, and they have taken a 44-20 lead into the halftime dressing room. Let's recap the scoring now. It all started after St. Francis won the toss deferred. They were going to get their defense out and try to test Missouri Valley. Guess what? The Vikings were ready to play right from the get-go. First two snaps, successful passes, and it would eventually set up a 16-yard Kenny Sanford touchdown run to the right side at the 13-19 mark. So the Vikings on the board as Johnson would add the extra point. Austin Johnson made it a 7-0 lead. And then the Cougars would come back, and they would engineer basically a ground-oriented drive. Started with a nice return on the kickoff by Justin Green. Had another run into Missouri Valley territory, and that would set up eventually a 5-yard touchdown run by Aaron Harris at the 11:03 mark. Knicks with the extra point, and we were in a 7-7 tie. Might have thought, well, both teams now settle down, and we'll see some defense. Not so fast, my friend, because it would be a Bridges to Devon Henry, 51-yard touchdown at the 9:13 mark. And Johnson with the extra point. Again, the Vikings took the one touchdown lead at 14-7. But St. Francis would come back. And you know that it's just a matter of time before Nick Ferrer would find his favorite 6'3 receiver in Seth Cote. And took him very little time on that next possession for the Cougars. They hooked up on a 67-yard touchdown pass. Ferrer with a great job of warding off a defender with a straight arm and then walking and tiptoeing down the left sidelines for the final 5 yards into the end zone. And Nix with the extra point. We are tied again at 14-all. But Missouri Valley not ready to go away on this frigid day. Bridges again, this time with a aerial toss and a touchdown to Siobhan Richardson. Good for 16 yards at the 5:39 mark. But the extra point was no good. It was a low snap. They tried the fire play. That did not avail themselves of anything. And it was a lead for Missouri Valley, but only 6, not 7 points at 20-14. And Justin Green would get the tying touchdown on a 5-yard touchdown run with 3:16 remaining as he ran off tackle to the right side. And Nix would at the extra point, and the Cougars would have their first lead of the day with just over 3 minutes remaining in that first quarter by 1 point, 21-20. There's been one turnover in the ball game, and that was an important one. Nashawn Lewis stepped in front of a receiver and intercepted Bridges, taking it to the Missouri Valley 39-yard line. That would be the end of the first quarter, but it would set up a one-yard touchdown run by P.J. Dean. Well, just seconds into the start of the second quarter, 14:57 remaining. Dean in from a yard out, but the Cougars, again, with a problem on the exchange from center. Fire play was no good. The extra point was no good, and the Cougars would lead by 7 at 27-20. From then on out, it was all St. Francis stopping the Missouri Valley Vikings. They did not score in that second quarter. Instead, Ferrer to Kelsall, little touch pass on a sweep. Good for 5 yards and a touchdown at the 8-11 mark. Knicks would add the extra point to make it 34-20. Cougars would get the ball back again, and Ferrer would find Coach with a highlight film catch as he caught the ball basically one-handed. Then with his momentum, a little crossing pattern from left to right, he was approaching the sidelines and kept his momentum from carrying him out of bounds. Reached back with the ball in the left hand, went airborne, and just crossed inside the pylon, crossed the plane of the goal. Touchdown for St. Francis at the 4:13 mark. Knicks with the extra point to make it 41-20. Cougars on the punt from Missouri Valley, took possession again late in the ball game, and would set up where we are right now. 27-yard field goal by Ryan Nix as time ran out. And that's where we are here at halftime in a 44-20 St. Francis lead. Cougars came in ranked number 4, 9-1 on the year, and right now enjoying a lead of 24 points. They have scored the last 30 points of this ball game, shutting out Missouri Valley in the second quarter. But still another 30 minutes of coverage remaining, and we'll step out for a break, and we'll be back with more of our halftime presentation. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Yeah, let's just run the 130. I'll try to save those. Well, we'll wait to get the official printout of the halftime numbers here in the half, in the first half, in the first 30 minutes.
Our final selection brings
Cougar
our
Pride marching band out there, and that's going to be a tough proposition, especially
decade.
If you have your lips and tongues on a cold day to some of that metal. Now we're seeing the snow reemerge again, blowing snow. Really, the start of the ball game, it really began coming out almost blizzard-like conditions, so much so that the field was virtually covered with snow. Then one of the things about the artificial surface, if you get any kind of sun, even brief sun, it tends to hold heat, and that it has melted the snow away. But again, we may see a lot of that pop-up showers throughout the rest of the day. Cougars came in one of three playoff contending teams from the Mid-States Football Association. The other two were defending national champions, undefeated, ranked number 1, Marian Knights. They were home today, and they are underway, hosting the 7-3 Robert Morris Eagles. Those two teams did play earlier in the season, with Marian winning handily, 45-7. So two of the three teams in the MSFA facing one another today. 16 started in all, 8 games in round 1. That number will be pared in half with the quarterfinals coming up next Saturday. Cougars hope to be back here against, obviously, an opponent to be named. But still work to be done. Their lead of 24 points. And a talented Missouri Valley Viking team that knows how to come from behind. 2 weeks ago against Baker, down 24-7. Battled back to take the lead in the fourth quarter, only to see Baker come back in the final minute and win that ball game. But I'm sure Coach Kevin Downey will be talking about how this is not a team that he's often used the term at halftime, even with big, substantial leads, go out there and play like it's 0-0. Well, ultimately, All these 16 playoff teams battling for the right to play for an NAIA National Championship down in Daytona Beach, Florida in December. But you've got to win three games to get a right to play for a national title. Well, obviously, the coldest day we've seen in college football. We've had some cool days a couple times, but nothing like today. And we were, as staff, before kickoff, we were remarking this has the makings looking very much like what we saw a few years ago down in the Sioux Falls, South Dakota, in a playoff day that was so brutal. It was early December, and it was so cold that my bottle of refreshment at halftime had frozen, and the wires that we use for our broadcast transmission that go into the telephone jack, they were frozen brittle solid. Let's take a look now at some of the first half numbers. Let's take a look at the total offensive production by both teams. Cougars have run 43 plays in the first half for 378 total offensive yards. Meanwhile, 10 plays fewer executed by the Vikings, 33 plays that run for 234 yards of total offense in the first half. Missouri Valley has done the only punting in the ball game three times for an average of 25.3. Cougars have been penalized twice for 23 yards, Vikings once for five. Third down conversions, Cougars are 5 of 7 in the first half, Missouri Valley 3 of 7. Red zone scores, Missouri Valley's been down there twice, they've scored both times. Cougars 6 times in the red zone, and they've come away with points on the board 6 times. Some of the individualing numbers now for St. Francis. Justin Green with 6 carries for 71 yards. He scored a touchdown. P.J. Dean, 4 chances for 33 yards. He scored a rushing touchdown. Aaron Harris, 6 carries for 21 yards and a touchdown. And Nick Ferrer, by the way, with a late scramble in that last drive, had positive yardage for 4 yards. Ferrer through the air, 16 of 25 for 246 yards, 3 touchdowns. No interceptions, no sacks. Some of the individual numbers for Missouri Valley. Kenny Sanford, 10 carries for net 40 yards, 1 touchdown. Jake Bridges on scramble, 7 carries and negative yardage on the scrambles. For passing, Jake Bridges, 12 of 16, very good efficiency for 199 yards, 2 touchdowns, 1 interception. He's been sacked twice. As far as the receiving, Devon Henry leads the Vikings with 3 catches, 75 yards, 1 touchdown. Dorian Stenard with 2 catches for 54 yards. Richardson, 2 catches, 21 yards and a touchdown. And Kenny Sanford, 2 catches for net 4 yards.
One more score update from the NAIA FCS.
See if we can pick this up.
At Reinhardt. Reinhardt leads Southeastern Florida 3-0. 9:36 to play in the first
3-0 Reinhardt of Georgia with the lead over Southeastern Florida. As far as the Cougar receiving, Seth Coate with 6 catches in the first half, 139 yards, 2 touchdowns. Keem Kelsall with 4 catches, 39 yards. He has a touchdown. McDowell, 2 for 29 yards. Sean Boswell, 2 for 22 yards. Spentdale not called upon a punt in the first half. Aaron Baum was. 3 punts for an average of 25.3, had a long of 27. Punt returns, Sean Boswell had 1 for 11 yards returned. Justin Green, kick returns. He had 2 kick returns for a total of 61 yards, a long of 38. Nicodemus, 1 for 23. Devon Henry, 4 kick returns for 80 yards. He had a long of 43. And Jacoby Bellard with 2 kick returns for a total of 25 yards. Let's take a look at some of the individual defensive numbers. Eric Dunton now with 8 tackles totally in the first half, has a half a sack, 1.5 tackles for loss. Pearson Harnish with a total of 5 tackles, 1.5 for loss, 1 sack. Lucas Sparks with 4 tackles in the first half, 3 for loss. Lee Stewart also with 3 tackles in that first half. And don't forget Nashawn Lewis with the interception that really paved the way to the Cougars starting this run of 30 unanswered points. As far as the Vikings, some of the defensive numbers, Jake King leads them with 8 tackles. Mark Plummer with 4 tackles. Juwan Cassidy with 4 tackles. And Antoine Palmer with 3 tackles. Halftime here at Darcy Stadium, 44-20. As we wait for the teams to come out. And let's pause once again. I'll tell you what, let's tell everybody about Bishop Lures High School. As you know, they are a Catholic educational community that instills in each student dignity, integrity, respect, and responsibility. You can catch the Lures spirit. Just go to their website at www.bishoplures.org. That's www.bishoplures.org. Catch the Lures spirit. Again, let's take a timeout. We'll be back with more of our halftime coverage. Cougar Football and Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Okay, we got one more 30. Is that correct? I gotcha. Joe Parson soldiering it along alone here today. No Sean McBride. We're missing him. He's out under the weather. And kidding him, I think you saw that weather forecast, what it was looking like, and decided maybe it may be a good day to stay home. No, seriously, said he's been battling an upper respiratory ailment. So we wish him well and a speedy recovery and hopefully a chance to come back here to Darcy Stadium next Saturday with the quarterfinal matchup, but you still got 30 minutes of playoff football here. Cougars won the toss, deferred. They'll get the ball to start the second half and trying to at least protect, if not add, to this 44-20 lead. Looking at some of the highlights, well, we talked about Seth Coate and Akeem Kelsall. Again, was really as one of those seniors that talked about, it's always got to be in the back of your mind, this might be it as a senior. If you lose today, your career is probably going to be done. And Kelsall has really done a good job with 4 catches today. 2 of them were highlight type of films. Not easy catches. Had to reach back behind him, low, high, but made difficult catches. And then Seth Coate, he's just a human highlight film. Every time he touches the football, seems to add to his reel of illustrious highlight catches. He's had the 67-yard touchdown catch. And then even a little bit more difficult on the creativity scale with momentum carrying him out of bounds. Wasn't as long, but getting the touchdown, 19 yards from Nick Ferrer with a ball that he had to reach, change hands to his left hand with his momentum carrying him out of bounds on the right sidelines. And just went airborne, in fact, to keep from stepping out of bounds and reached with the left hand and broke the plane of the goal just inside the pylon to get that touchdown. So great job today, and Nick Ferrer with 246 passing yards and 3 touchdowns already in this first half. But, you know, as much as anything, the Cougars with the ability to run the football somewhat, and that has been a key. Cougars had 18 rushes in the first half for 132 yards. And we talked about that might be a key, because in 2 of the last 3 ball games that the Cougars did win, but they had run for only 70 yards against Davenport 2 weeks ago and then 73 yards against Robert Morris. And, of course, here in that tough loss on October the 1st against Marion, they managed only 22 yards on the ground against the Knights, a game that they led at halftime. But really just everything fell apart in the second half, and Marion came back to win that ball game on October the 1st. Cougars, I know, in the back of their mind, looking down the road eventually with the possibility of looking for the opportunity to go back to Marion. Cougars won last year in the regular season at Marion. They would feel confident going down and playing at Marion if it should come to pass. But we will see a lot of football between now and then. Teams coming out trying to warm up and get ready for the start of the second half. As it's a 44-20 St. Francis lead, ranked number 4 coming into today's ball game against the 12th ranked Missouri Valley College Vikings. We'll be back with the start of the second half. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Parson back with you here as we get ready for the start of the second half. Teams limbering up on the sidelines. Cougars won the toss. They deferred. They'll get the ball to start the second half. And down 24 points, you almost might not be surprised to see head coach Paul Trott try something, maybe an onside attempt. They've got to get possessions. They've got to get the ball and try to fight their way back, trailing at 44-20. St. Francis, of course, really trying to manage the clock now, more importantly than anything. Points would be great, but that would be icing on the cake. Just trying to run through the next 30 minutes. But again, you've always got to be concerned about a team that's got a big lead, that sometimes if you get away with from what has been successful, you can allow an opponent opportunities to come back and take that lead away. Justin Green, he'll drop back in kick return. He did a great job, had two kick returns, along of 38 in the first half, total of 61 kick return yards. Cougars will work from right to left in this third quarter. And let's see, we do have four men up at the line of scrimmage for St. Francis. Vikings do spread things out. Baum has been doing the kickoff duties today. He'll tee it up at the 35-yard line. Day started out at 37 degrees, our temperature. It's not going to get any warmer, folks.
Kicking off from Missouri Valley, 39, Aaron Baum.
Baum does tee it up at the 35. Right now they're spread out. So we'll see. The Cougars now with four men up front. Actually, six men within about 7 yards of the line of scrimmage. Here comes the kick, and it's a low line drive bounding ball. Picked up at the 23, Nicodemus. Works to the 25, 30. Spins off a tackle at the 40 and lowers the shoulder. And what, did the ball pop free? Let's see.
Jason Nicodemus on the return.
And he did. The ball popped free, and Missouri Valley's got it.
Missouri Valley.
I thought Nicodemus was down, but no, the ball was free before he hit the turf. And it's a fumble recovery, so a great opportunity, as we mentioned, for the Vikings, as they will have the fumble recovery, first and 10 at the USF 48-yard line. Cougars had one turnover in the first half, a Nishon Lewis interception, and now it's first and 10 for Missouri Valley at the St. Francis 48. So a quick turnabout, and now let's see what freshman quarterback Jake Bridges does with the opportunity. Splits too wide to the right side on this first down call. Looks quarterback draw coming up to the left side and spun around. He'll get into Cougar territory. A couple of yards deeper down to about
Jake
the 46. Bridges had a couple of scrambled runs in the first half. In fact, his ended up with seven carries for negative yardage. Sacked three times in that first half. Picks up two, second down and eight. Cougars now showed it. A blitz coming defensive right side. Empty backfield. Here's a quick throw. The catch is made, but Nashawn Lewis lowers the boom as a quick catch was made short of the first down.
Number 14, Siobhan Richardson.
It was Siobhan Richardson on the catch. And it'll bring up third down and a long three.
Number eight, Nashawn Lewis of the Cougars.
Trying to get to the Cougar 37-yard, 38-yard line on this snap. Kenny Sanford remains in as the running back. They're going to flank him out to the right side. Empty backfield now for the Vikings. They need 3 yards. 13:45 remaining in the third quarter. Short drop. There's a throw to the right side. That's a catch made by Bellard, and he's down to the Cougar 32. Little quick pitch and catch. Coward came over. Had some help from Jarrell Holman. But again, they'll move the chains, and on the move are the Vikings. First and 10 at the St. Francis 32-yard line. Cody Hendricks is in as the tight end right now. And let's see if they are going to. They'll put him tight to the right side. Bellard up on the slot to the left side. Twins out there to the wide side of the field. Now Bridges checks off. Still 8 on the play clock. And looking deep. No quarterback run is coming, and he runs right into a wall. Nudges forward to about the 33. That'll be a gain of a yard only. Nobody there. One of the linemen for Missouri Valley comes up limping. That's Troy Jones. That's the starting center.
In the north end. Once again, Natalie Bussey to the ticket office.
Anytime you lose your center, that creates all kind of potential problems with the exchange, especially if you're snapping to the pistol or shotgun formations, which they will be doing right now. But Jones comes up and stays in the ball game. Second down and 9 after that gain of only a yard. Bridges again looks behind and says something to Sanford. Lined up behind him in the one back position. And a high snap, but here's a play action fake. Rolled to the right side. Bridges looks, lofts the ball up. That one's intercepted. Wilmer Cole played it well. Heiser was the intended receiver. Talking to the field judge, he thought he was impeded. We don't see it, and it's going to rule it an interception. The Cougars, their second of the game. First one for Wilmer Cole. So Wilmer Cole with the pick, and the Cougars will have it first and 10 at their 15-yard line. There was a penalty. It was against Missouri Valley. That's declined. Cougars will take the play and the interception. Then they'll take over possession of the football. So the kickoff fumble is avenged as St. Francis denies Missouri Valley. They commit their second turnover of the ball game.
After the interception, the Cougars will start first and 10 on their own 13-yard line.
And they'll start at the 13-yard line is where they spot that ball. Quick look at Wilmer Cole this year. That's his second interception. And one of the co-leaders, passes defended with 5 coming in and 6 passes defended. Here's the draw coming up. Green in the clear 20-25. And he busted all the way out across the 30 to about the 31-yard line. Justin Green with the deep handoff, and then he just exploded to the B gap. They'll mark that ball just across the Cougar 30-yard line. Gain of nearly 18 yards on that run by Justin Green, who in the first half, Green had 71 yards. Here's Ferrer, deep handoff once again. They start left now. Green cuts it to the right side. Straight arms one. Penalty flag is thrown. Looking back in the direction of Brian Gegner. And that one, David White threw the flag in the secondary. The backfield, I should say, of St. Francis. That one's coming back.
Antoine Palmer, the penalty marker on the field.
Cougars had 2 penalties in the first half for 23 yards. That'll wipe out the gain. Green had taken the ball out to about the 36. David White, our referee. Still waiting for some kind of offsetting penalties. We had a face mask penalty against Missouri Valley and the holding call against St. Francis. So they'll bring the ball back to the 31-yard line and just a basic do-over. First and 10 from the USF 31-yard line. Ferrer out of the pistol, hands the ball to Green, looking for running room, and he squirts through off the right side again across the 35 to about the 37-yard line. With Justin Green again bobbing and weaving, looking first left, then cut back to the right. Now we have another Viking player down. Trying to get the number. This has been a hard-hitting ball game today. 11:21 remains here in the third quarter. Again, just to recap a little bit of our scoring. Three possessions, three touchdowns by Missouri Valley in the first quarter as they just moved the football almost at will. But a missed extra point kind of left the door open, and USF responded. They had answered each of those scores with one of their own and then took the lead, their first of the day at 21-20. And that was part of a 30-point run by St. Francis that culminated on the field goal by Ryan Nix right before intermission to make it 44-20. Juwan Cassidy was the injured safety, but he runs off the field under his own power. Looks like he's okay. So a gain of 7 by Justin Green. He'll stay in as the running back. Nicodemus is in as well now. Cougars will work from the right side hash mark. Second down and 3 at the 38. Two twins, two wide to the near side. A motion now by Nicodemus that way as well. And they'll play action fake. Here's Ferrer. Rolls back to the right. Is going to be hit and dropped. That time ran out of options and knocked down back around the 30-yard line. It's been the first time, really, that the Vikings have been able to get to him. They had no sacks in the first half. Thayer got there. So, basically, it's a loss. It'll bring up third down and 11 with the ball back at the 30-yard line. Cougars trying to get out to their own 41-yard line now. Ferrer, good job of deception, but then could not find a receiver open and had to just basically go down and take the loss. Takes the snap again, looking for the quick throw. Checks down, hits Nicodemus, 35, 40, 45. And behind the defense, inside the 35 to the 30-yard line, and finally bumped out of bounds as coming across to hit him was Nate DeSimone. Boy, that saved the touchdown. But Ferrer, good job of executing the checkdowns. Wanted to go deeper on the quick slant on the fly pattern, but could not find the receiver open and found Nicodemus wide open. So he takes it from the 30 all the way down to the 27-yard line of Missouri Valley. First and 10 as the Cougars on the move once again, leading it by 24 points, trying to add to that lead. McDowell in wide to the right side. Other than that, a tight formation now. Motion right to left. Kelsall, they'll give it to Green. Justin Green, little shake and bake move. And then they wrap up on him and drop him inside Justin the 25-yard line at the 24.
By number 30, Justin Gallegos.
Gallegos came up and made the stop from his safety position. That'll be a gain of 4, second down and 6. Boy, Justin Green running hard today.
He brings up second down and 7. From the Missouri Valley, 24-yard line.
Green will stay in as the running back. He'll be flanked to the left of Nick Ferrer. They'll stay in that goal line offense. Just one wide, McDowell to the short side, to the right. Here's Ferrer's got motion by Kelsall. Wants to throw, though, looking for McDowell. And looking, and boy, that time penalty flag was thrown. Waiting.
Is incomplete. Their penalty marker.
Official
in the
end zone did not throw a penalty flag. Boy, McDowell had his right hand up, and as much as anything, trying to indicate to the officials he was being held on the play. Let's see how they rule it now. David White, our referee, will let us know here momentarily. Umpire and David White still conferring. It's going to be pass interference. They walk the yardage off, I believe. And that'll take the ball down inside the 10 to about the 9-yard line. Seems to be some confusion among the
Pass interference, defense number 9. The ball will be placed at the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
Juwan Cassidy has ruled the pass interfere. So it'll be first and goal now from the 9-yard line. Nate Carson in is wide to the left to come up and press coverage on him. McDowell wide to the right and playing about five steps off. Gegner is in as the...
The point will be 15 yards from the previous spot. First down.
Was a 15-yard penalty walk-off. Gegner up on the wing, I should say, to the left side. And Cote, I believe, is in there tight to the right. And here we go now. First and goal from the 9-yard line. Green stays in at the running back. Gegner a little motion left to right. And they'll hand the ball Green. Green looking for running room. Steps out one tackle. No, he didn't. Brought down right back
Green, the ball carrier.
At the 9-yard line. That'll be no gain. What Green looked like, if he could have got to the outside, he had a chance. Kilgore might have got just enough of him, along with Thayer in there. Second and goal still from the 9. Now the ball will be placed down at the left side hash mark. Kelsaw up on the right wing. Gegner on the left wing. Ferrer barking out the signals. He's got Kelsaw in motion. Gives to Green. Trying to sweep to the right side. No, it throws back to the left. That's a ball caught by Selko. Well disguised that time by Ferrer. Thought he handed the ball off. He did not. Throws back 9 yards into the end zone, a wide open Seth Cote at the 8:26 mark. And the Cougars, execution perfect right there once again with the 9-yard touchdown. Ferrer now with his fourth touchdown of the day. So the interception by Wilmer Cole pays off a dividends with points on the board on the 9-yard scoring toss. Now Nix comes on to attempt the extra point. End over end on the way, and it is good. So 51 on the board for St. Francis. 51-20 our score. 8:26 remaining in this third quarter. We'll be back. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Joe Parson with you here at Darcy Stadium. Frigid conditions, and boy, tell you what, is not bothered St. Francis. They have been hot today, executing the offense with 51 points on the board already, and still 8:26 remaining in this third quarter. And if you're Missouri Valley, you had to feel you had the Cougars maybe where you wanted them. As you get the ball on a kickoff recovery, fumble recovery, had it at the USF 48-yard line, but not able to do anything with it. And Wilmer Cole saw that on his interception that gave St. Francis possession back at the 13, and it would lead ultimately to this 9-yard Ferrer to Seth Cote touchdown toss here about midway through this third quarter. Bellard back there again in kick return. Here's a kick coming his way, and he's got it at the 9. We'll bring it out. Bellard now, we're looking across the 20 to the 25, wrapped up and dropped. Boy, I tell you what, I was focused on a play a little bit away from, and one of the Vikings just basically tackled one of the Cougar defenders. I mean, it was no block. He just took both hands and wrapped them up and threw them to the ground. Anyway, it will be first and 10 for the Vikings at the USF 20, at the Missouri Valley 24-yard line. Well, Jake Bridges, freshman who has had a great year, 26 touchdowns to start the day. and over 2,500 passing yards, and he will get only better, and he's got a great running mate in Kenny Sanford, also a freshman. Bridges looking, now steps up in the pocket, throws off the left side, has got a bobbled catch. That's Richardson to midfield, inside the 40 to the 35-yard line, and down to the 33 goes Siobhan Richardson.
Number 14, Siobhan Richardson.
There is a penalty flag. David White will let us know, and it's coming back. Holding.
That is holding on the offense number 62. It's a 10-yard penalty. We play first down.
Troy Jones, the center, caught with a hold. So that wipes out the big gainer. They had it all the way down to the St. Francis 34. Get a lot of time for Bridges. Cougars finally got to him in that second quarter. And registered officially two sacks. And he had a number of tackles for loss. But now the penalty will move it back to, it'll be first down and 20 with the ball back around the 14-yard line. Empty backfield again for Bridges. High snap has got it. Look, steps up on the pocket, got away from one. Works the left side, lowers the shoulder, took a big hit by Nashawn Lewis. And driven way back around the 10-yard line. So the quarterback scamper run.
He was stopping number 8, Nashawn.
It'll be a gain across the 21 to the 22-yard line. So he gets a lot of that penalty yardage back and bringing up second down and 12. We've seen Bridges more likely and thinking about the running with the football than we did in the first half. And on a cold day, who can blame him? He's only 5'9", goes 180 pounds. Short drop, pulling it down. Here's Bridges now, checks off, throws to the left, and nearly intercepted again. Well, that one, Marcus Stepp. By the way, update on Seth Coates' great day. 3,001 career yards now. He needs 57 to pass Cam Smith at number two. Cam with 3,056 yards in his career. Boy, Marcus Stepp had it in his hands again, but just slipped out, and it'll bring up third down and 12. Boy, Marcus Stepp, last couple of weeks, has really elevated his game out of Bishop Dwinger High School, the 6'2 sophomore, 225-pounder, now third down and 12. Trying to get out to their own 34. Here's Bridges, drops the throw. A lot of time in the pocket, throws it as far as he can. He's got a man out there, and the ball is caught and then dropped in and out of the hands of Dorian Stenard.
Bridges pass, and center number 4, Dorian Stenard, is incomplete and brings up fourth down.
That one was dying. The wind was knocking it down. Stenard tried to sit down with the ball, but the ground separated him from control of the football. And it'll bring up fourth down. Boy, sometimes days and games are like that, separated maybe just by a drop pass here or there. Baum in to punt the ball away. Average only about 25 yards a punt at 3 attempts in the first half. He's inside the 10. Boswell moves up outside the Cougar 45. Rush is coming. The kick is away, though. And this one hits at the 48. Takes a Viking bounce inside the 40 of USF. Still rolling. Down around the 31 is where it will come to a stop. So the Cougars are scored on their last possession on the 9-yard Ferrer to Sethco touchdown.
Stop at the Cougar 31-yard line.
Well, they'll get the ball back now with 6:45 remaining in this third quarter. First and 10 at the USF 31-yard line. Stenard, one of those guys, by the way, led him with over 800 receiving yards coming in. 5 catches, 125 last week in the victory with 1 touchdown over Mid-America Nazarene. But a ball that, boy, they really needed that time to give him possession into St. Francis territory. Now Ferrer wanting to throw again, being pursued. Got rid of the ball, puts it up and threw it away. That time they were bearing down on Nick Ferrer, and a little jump pass cleared it away and saved the day with 6:39 remaining in this third quarter. Second down and 10 coming up. Once again, the big nose tackle, Kyerton Kilgore, hobbled, and he's going to walk off the field. He was injured in the first half, came back in. but a big imposing force, a 6'1 junior at 305. Let's see if Middendorf now comes in to replace him.
Intentional grounding on the offense number 13.
Oh, wow, they're going to call that intentional grounding. They ruled he was not out of the box.
Second down.
So a loss of down as well. That'll move the ball back inside the 20 to the 17-yard line. Let's see. They're going to spot that ball at the 18. It will be second down and very long. Cougars trying to eventually find their way up to their own 41. Ferrer out of the pistol, right side once again. Let's see if they'll run the ball. And no, it's going to be a quick screen near side. Kelsaw at the 15-20. Angles near side across the 25. Steps out of bounds around the 28-yard line. Got a lot of that penalty yardage back, and that'll bring up third down. Third and about 14. And now is where St. Francis tries to find that 41-yard line on this snap coming up. Harris was in for a moment, but they'll bring in Nicodemus as the running back. And let's see if they try to screen something his way. Meanwhile, three wide to the right, the wide side of the field. Ferrer looks that way, steps up, going to be hit and downed. They're getting more to Nick Ferrer now in the second half, and a loss back to the 21-yard line.
Brings up fourth down.
So we will see the first St. Francis punt of the day with 5:58 remaining in this third quarter. Spitnail 2 weeks ago at Davenport had a long of 44, averaged 39 yards on punts. For the year, he's averaging over 40 yards a punt. Vikings with one back and punt return at the Viking 40-yard line. Spitnail now backs up, waits for the snap at the Cougar 8. And the kick is away, got a beautiful spiral. That one they're going to let hit inside the 40, and it takes a Cougar bounce inside the 30 all the way down to the 26-yard line. Josh Spitnail with a great job. Perfect spiral punt, and the Vikings wanted no part of it. They will have the football back now with 5:21 remaining in this third quarter. Vikings have not scored since they took a 20-14 lead with 5:39 remaining in the first quarter. On a Bridges to Richardson 16-yard touchdown pass. But they have the ability with talented receivers to get open, and St. Francis cannot let up. Holman and Stewart are two back, and they're going to be joined. So Cougars will basically have three back. Running back stays in there now, flanked to the right. That's usually Sanford. Of Jeff Bridges, the 5'9 freshman quarterback. He's got the snap, quarterback draw all the way, running right side. And he's got some room, and he took a hit across the 30 to the 32. That was, I believe it was Marcus Stepp.
Bridges on the keeper.
It was Marcus Stepp who made his mark on Jeff Bridges, but it nonetheless is a gain of 8. That's a gutsy run by a little guy. 5'9 quarterback.
Second down and two.
Bridges came in with over 100 carries for 346 yards on the ground and led the Vikings with 7 rushing touchdowns. Empty backfield now, 4 wide to the wide side. Looks back near side, throws the ball, no chance. That one short hopped into Dorian Stenard. So it'll be third down and still 2 coming up.
Brings up third down.
Well, cold day, wind blowing. Very tough to keep your hands warm and get that good, sure-handed grip on the football. Cougars bring in James Jamisich defensively now. Carlin Coleman has seen some snaps defensively as well. Sparks stays out there with Helmelgarn. And Jamisich getting instructions from Helmelgarn how they want him to be lined up. Trying to get pressure now. Empty backfield once again. Sparks trying to pinch in from the left side. There was movement, and let's see, there are penalty flags. It'll be procedure.
First down, offense 71. Sparks penalty, third down.
So instead of third down and 2, it'll be third down and 7.
At
after the penalty.
Vikings had just one penalty in the first half for 5 yards. That's a costly one. Now makes it third down and 7. They try to reach their own 36-yard line on this snap. They'll stay with the same empty backfield, Bridges. Waiting to take that snap, has got it. Quick release, throws near side, and ball is dropped. And that may have been ruled, no catch in and out of the hands of Richardson. Tried to move with it.
Jake Bridges pass.
Before he had control of it, and now they're going to have to punt again. So two opportunities for Missouri Valley at the start of the second half offensively, and they come away with no points. And Baum will have to come in once again to kick the ball away. Boswell flexing the arms, trying to limber up, get the blood circulating a little bit in this 25-degree wind chill that we've experienced right since kickoff. Started today at 37 degrees actual temperature. Not going to get any warmer than that. 4:34 remaining here in the third quarter. Baum waits at his own 15. Cougars dropping back. There was movement again. Now they shift back. Play clock is at 11. They've got time. And here is the snap. Baum almost blocked that time. Dutton came in. Takes a high bounce at the 49-yard line of Missouri Valley. Boy, Dutton came in, and I mean just missed a chance at a block. Ian Gaston now, shake hands. They know how close they came. And St. Francis nonetheless will have great field position at the 49. Was there a penalty flag? David White is coming over. Don't see a flag down. There is a discussion going on. And they will just rule it first and 10 for St. Francis at the Viking. Now they're going to move it back. They were never into Cougar territory. Yeah, they're having some problems with communication on the chain gang over there with the official out that way. And they do mark it at the 49-yard line. Are they move it back? No, they do move it to the 49 of Missouri Valley. Well, it's a cold day. And Nick Ferrer comes back ready to take care of business. Looks out of the pistol, hands the ball off. Here's a cutback to the left. Boy, there's great defense.
P.J.
Dean got the call, but Thayer came breaking through there and grabbed him almost at the time that he took off. Dean did see him. P.J. Dean did see Thayer coming, trying to cut back to his left, but Thayer lightning quick. And it's a half a yard loss. They'll go to Dean again. Off tackle run to the right side. Straight arms one. Cuts to the 45 and out of bounds. Close to a first down around the 41 or 42. Depends where they say he stepped out of bounds. Thayer now slow getting up. Picks his body up off the turf. And they're going to say that Dean stepped out of bounds at about the 43-yard line. So it'll bring up third down and a short four.
The Missouri Valley 43-yard line.
Cougars trying to reach the 39 on this snap. Leading at 51-20. Still over 3.5 minutes time remaining in this third quarter. Ferrer again with two wide to the left side. Wants to throw. Short drop. Now checks off. Throws back left side and nobody home. And will he draw a penalty flag again?
Ferrer's pass.
Nobody there. Ferrer beginning to kind of hear footsteps. Now they're just going to call it throw the ball away to bring up fourth down and the long three. Cougars going to run a play now, trying to reach the 39. They do not bring in Spitnail. To 20 with 3:36 remaining quarter three action. Again, two wide to the left, one to the right. Gegner in the slot. Here is a quick throw near side. Coates got it and dumped. But he's got the first down at the 37-yard line. They'll give him another yard to the 36. The tackling by Missouri Valley has been a lot crisper and sure in the second half. But the Cougars have scored one time in this second half. And they led 44-20 at halftime. Now improving field position. Now Boswell walking away, and what do we have? Timeout called.
Timeout, Missouri Valley.
Yeah, the Vikings want to take a timeout and try to regroup defensively, trying not to fall any further behind. 3:16 remains in this third quarter. 51-20 our score, and we'll step out. This is Cougar football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Sorry for coughing in your ear. Quick timeout, and the teams are back out there. It'll be first and 10 USF. They've got it at the Viking 36-yard line. Moving from right to left. Cougars led at halftime 44-20. They've added one more score in the third quarter. Now up 51-20. And Ferrer out of the left side hash mark once again. Short drop, pump fake. Now throws the fade. He's got McDowell out there by the ball. He caught the ball and then dropped it. His momentum carrying him out of bounds. That ball sailed a little bit on Ferrer. Again, any throw to the far side of the field, that's the east side, is going to be windblown. McDowell standing out there was waiting for the ball, and he could see it was carrying. And had he held on, I don't know if they would have ruled it. They got a foot in bounds. It would have been a spectacular catch. Now it's second down and 10. Nicodemus up on the left wing. And Ferrer hands the ball off. Here's Dean, and not going anywhere. Will not get back to the line of scrimmage.
P.J. Dean, the ball carrier.
They pinched in from both sides.
Tackle on the play by 45, Patrick Overby.
Aguilar was there to have a hand in the stop. Loss of one, third down and 11.
Loss of one brings up third down and 11.
Well, the Vikings have not lost any of their defensive intensity, and they picked it up quite a bit here in the second half. Rocky James checks into the game, sent wide to the right. And flanked inside of him will be Boswell. Code is wide to the short side to the left. They come up and press coverage on him. Cougars need 11. Pump fake again. And Ferrer looks now, being pursued. Rolls to the right side, got away from one. Taking a look, and is going to go down. No, he's still on his feet. Comes back, throws late near side, and then the diving attempt. Code can't find the handle.
There's pass, and gunner number 11, Seth Code, is incomplete.
Again, good coverage downfield, taking away the downfield passing options for Ferrer. John Battle had the coverage that time on Coat, tried to come back and help his quarterback. To be honest with you, I thought Ferrer was throwing the ball away, but Coat tried to come back and make the play. And USF with the ball at the 37 of Missouri Valley. Again, not to, they're disdaining the punt. They'll try to pick up the 11 yards on this snap. Clock down to 2:14 remaining. Same set, two wide to the right, Coat to the left. Short drop, Ferrer looks, steps up, throws in the slot. He's got to catch McDowell. Breaks away inside the 15, to the 10, to the 5, and a touchdown. Monte McDowell. Fourth down and 11 turns into a 37-yard touchdown play. Ferrer to Monte McDowell. McDowell, his first touchdown catch of the day at the 2:04 mark.
And that touchdown was brought to you by our friends at Advent Dentistry.
That's touchdown toss number 5 on the day for Ferrer. First time today to McDowell. And for McDowell, that is his 7th touchdown catch of the year. Came in with over 600 yards receiving. And Nix looking to make it a 58-20 lead. Right-footed kick, driven high, long, and good. So Nix hits the extra point here in the third quarter. 58-20, USF with a timeout down below. And this is Cougar playoff football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Yeah. Well, the Cougar lead grows to 38 points now here with still just over 2 minutes remaining in this third quarter. And really you have to be a little bit amazed and surprised because this looked like it was going to be a shootout at the very start of this ball game. Three possessions. And three touchdowns by the Vikings. Cougars did counter. But since taking a 21-20 lead, they have just said goodbye to Missouri Valley, now leading at 58-20. By the way, the Cougars back in 2008 beat Pikeville 58-3, so the Cougars have tied that playoff record right now with still a quarter remaining and 2:04 in this third quarter. Nix ready to kick the ball away again right to left. Drives it high end over end. Backpedaling. It's taken high at the 10-yard line. Here's a run. Bellard cuts to the 20 and trying to work his way across the 25. He does to about the 26. And the Vikings will try to go to work once again offensively. Last time they put points on the board at the 5:39 mark of the third quarter. That gave them, after a missed extra point, a 20-14 lead. They have not scored since. Cougars have had two interceptions today, one by Nashawn Lewis, and more recently one by Wilmer Cole. Both of them turned into points on the board with Cougar touchdowns. Cam Shackelford now checks in at left defensive end for St. Francis. Vikings will stay with the empty backfield. Kind of a tight version of it, though. Bridges, short drop again. Wants to throw, can't find anything. Throws the ball near side. Tip ball. Cole was looming in the vicinity, trying to find Kenny Sanford. But at 5'9", that ball off his hands, tantalizing, hung in the air just for a brief moment, and Wilmer could not find the handle. Cougars now bring in Blake Schumacher into the safety position, into the game. Cole still out there along with Eric Denton, Pearson Harnish, Spencer Cowherd. It'll be second down and 10. Vikings with the ball at their own 26. Trying to reach their own 36-yard line. Now with a protector in, that's a low snap. Bridges now buys time, rolls to his left, flings the ball, and it didn't get there. Knocked down, looking for Damon Henry, Devon Henry.
Devon Henry is incomplete.
And it'll bring up third down. Bridges has got kind of a slinging sidearm motion to some of those deep passes. Doesn't always step into the ball, just counts on arm strength to get it out there, and that time it was knocked down and did not reach the intended receiver, Henry. Third down and 10. Vikings were 3 of 7 in the first half on third down conversions. They try to work to their own 36. They'll stay with the empty backfield. Pump fake, wheel to the left side. Here's Bridges being pursued. Got rid of the ball and then knocked down. Let's see. There is a penalty flag. It's going to be roughing the passer, I believe. David White, the referee, threw the flag. Harnish had some words for one of the linemen out there. They're still continuing to talk a little bit.
Potential grounding, offense number one. The Panthers also got the spot of the foul. We've had mixed down, fourth down.
Okay, let's stand corrected. It was not roughing the passer. It's ruled a grounding, intentional grounding. Penalty moves the ball back and loss of down as well, so the ball moves back to the 12. And St. Francis is going to get excellent field position out of this with 96 seconds remaining in the third quarter. Cougars will have 10 men up on the line of scrimmage. Now they're going to drop off a couple. Boswell waits back at the Viking 40-yard line. Baum sets up 3 yards deep in the end zone to this punt. Last time he nearly had one blocked. They come again, got it away. Wobbly ball, not deep. Boswell backpedaling. Lost the football, but it goes out of bounds at the Cougar 48. Well, as we mentioned, on a day with 40-mile-an-hour wind gust, you know that ball's knuckling up there and very difficult at best to locate it. That went off the hands of Sean Boswell, but his momentum was carrying to the sideline anyway. And they will spot it at the 49 of St. Francis. Was there a penalty?
Holding, offense number 46, kicking team number 46, and a 10-yard penalty, first down.
It was a penalty against a Missouri Valley for holding. So that will be enforced now. Where are they going to mark the ball? Should be from the 49. And they'll take it to the Missouri Valley 41-yard line.
After the penalty, the Cougars begin first and 10. On the
Cougars going to stay Missouri with their first-team offense, basically, out there with Ferrer at quarterback and Justin Green as the running back. Nicodemus, Kelsaw, and Cote, the three-wide package to the left side. That's the wide side of the field. Ferrer's been under more pressure, though, in the third quarter. He does have two touchdown passes in this second half. He's got motion now by Nicodemus, resets on the wing. And Ferrer looks, hands the ball to Green. Looking for a block, cuts it up the middle, inside the 30, to the 25. In a foot race inside the 15, to the 10, to the 5. And Green looking to reach the pylon. Touchdown! Wow, what an effort. 49 yards. One play. Snap after the punch. And a run and an effort at the end by Justin Green to escape the would-be tacklers trying to catch up to him. Just pure strength at the end there, reaching out, and before the knee hit, able to touch the football to the pylon, touchdown. So the Cougars on the board again with 1:17 remaining in this third quarter. That's now a record. 58 points back in 2008. Against Pikeville, now with 64 points on the day. And still better than a quarter remaining. 1:17 still on the clock here in the third quarter. Nix has been perfect today. Right-footed kick is on the way, and it is good. So, 65-20. Lead of 45 points for St. Francis. Timeout down below. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Well, just an impressive run by Justin Green, 49 yards, and just a lot of strength employed by the young running back. He, you know, he's still just a sophomore, 5'10", 186, but able to drag tacklers close to the pylon and just reached out at the last second before the knee hit and got that touchdown. Well, Missouri Valley in some ways got to be wondering what happened. They've got to feel like they had the fourth-ranked Cougars right where they wanted. Three possessions to start the game, three touchdowns, only to see it all milled away here. And down 65-20. Nick's getting ready now to kick it away once again. Low line drive, a wind caught that one, and Richardson had to turn from behind over the shoulder catch. Brings it back across the 10, 15, 20, cuts to the left and got to the 25 and out to about the 26. So Missouri Valley ready to go to work once again offensively.
There's a penalty marker on the field.
There was a penalty flag thrown. Again, there's been some chippy play, especially after the whistles, both sides of the ball.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct on the kicking team number 32. So first unsportsmanlike conduct foul again will be first down.
Yeah, that one is an unsportsmanlike conduct call. Malachi Mannion whistled for the penalty. So that will give some improving field position, 15-yard walk-off against St. Francis. And the Vikings will have first and 10 at their own 42-yard line. Still 1:09 on the clock.
After the penalty, Missouri Valley will start.
Vikings have gone all the way today with 5'9 freshman quarterback Jake Bridges. And also Kenny Sanford, another freshman at 5'9 as the running back. And they look on the draw, give to Sanford, trying to cut back to the right side. Runs into Lucas Sparks, who makes the tackle on his knees. Sanford saw pressure coming from Dutton, tried to cut back right into the hands. Waiting was Lucas Spark. So Sparks with the tackle, assisted by Dutton. It will be a gain of about a yard and a half. Second down, let's call it 8 for the Vikings in the final seconds of this third quarter. They have the ball at their own 44-yard line now. Bridges out of the shotgun formation. Sanford, the protector, off to his left side. Twins out there to the wide side of the field. Again, they'll pitch the ball to him, and there's Sanford. And boy, that's going nowhere. As the Cougars came pouring through there, that was Marcus Stepp. I tell you, the last two or three weeks, he has really emerged as one of the leading tacklers for St. Francis. So a loss back around the 39-yard line. And they'll wait for the final seconds to clear in this third quarter. And we will move to quarter four action with the Cougars in dominating style today. The fourth-ranked USF Cougars on top after three quarters here at Garcia Stadium, 65-20 over Missouri Valley College. We'll be back with more of our fourth quarter coverage. This is Cougar Football and Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana. Yeah, Robert will save that 60 for the end, and may need some filler spots here the rest of the way, depending. Okay, buddy. Let's take a look at the line score of the ball game. It was a 21-20 Cougar lead at the end of the first quarter. They battled back three times from deficits. They scored 20 more points in the second quarter, lead 41-20 at halftime, and now have put 14 more points on the board. In this, actually, they've got 21 points on the board in the this third quarter. They lead it 65-20. And here we go now, a little misdirection as the here's a quarterback keeper. Now he throws the ball, bobbled ball, and lost by hand Sanford. Boy, they faked a double reverse. And a little spin play by Kenny Bridges. Got very creative out there, but Sanford could not find the handle.
On the punt from Missouri Valley, number 39, Aaron Baum. Deep to the Cougars, number 19, Sean Boswell.
Baum has been a busy guy today, kicking the ball away. He'll wait again at his 25-yard line. Cougars will have 10 men up at the line of scrimmage. They have come close a couple of times today at blocks. Low snap, Baum got it away. Wobbly ball, Boswell looking up and calls fair catch and has got it at his own 28. So St. Francis now in the final 14-43 of this ball game. It always is amazing how games can turn around. It looked like Missouri Valley was real. They were legit. Had the Cougars on their heels. St. Francis had nothing defensively to answer Missouri Valley in the early moments of the ball game. And suddenly the light went on. And the defense came to play, reemerged, and St. Francis now with this lead 65-20 after scoring now 21 points in the third quarter. Let's see, I think we've got a change at quarterback. We do. It's Cenarius in there. Hands the ball. Harris off tackle run and brings it across the 30 to about the 34-yard line. Good run by Aaron Harris. And he'll pick up about 6. Yeah, maybe closer to 7 yards. As they'll spot that nose of the football just inside the USF 35-yard line. Rocky James in wide to the right. Nate Carson is out there as well. Let's see if that's Gaston up in the slot. And Cenarius, Clay Cenarius in at quarterback. And looks to hand to Harris once again. Looking to run off tackle, straight arms one. Then went airborne and got knocked out of bounds.
Aaron Harris, the ball carrier.
Coming over to make that play was Gallegos from his
Patrick Overby, number 30,
safety position.
Gallegos.
And that'll keep it at third down and five after the loss of a yard on the play. Ball back at the Cougar 34-yard line. Cenarius, a freshman out of Michigan, 6'4", 184, 13 of 19 through the year for 131 yards, one touchdown. Did play at Davenport, 1-for-1 for 13 yards. Out of the pistol, wants to throw a short, throws the ball near side. James went down, could not make the catch, though. Would have had the first down, so bring up fourth down. And the Cougars will have to kick the ball away.
And brings up fourth down.
So Spitnail trots out, trying to flex the legs in running style as he runs out onto the field. Meanwhile, back in punt return is Justin Heiser. He's got 16 punt returns on the year, has a long of 63, good for a touchdown. Had two punt returns for no yardage last week, and now whistle blows. Play clock still at six. Let's see what we have here.
Illegal substitution on the defense. It's a 5-yard penalty.
Oh, wow. Illegal substitution penalty against the Missouri Valley. Guess what? It was fourth down and a long four. That is going to bring the offense back on with the automatic first down. So St. Francis will have the offense still on the field. And now we need to go to the roster with all the new names coming in. Will Chrisman will check in as a wideout. Take a look at those third quarter numbers when we get a chance. Cougars into the goal line offense now with Cenarius out there in the pistol in the quarterback spot. Motion, Nicodemus in there from left to right. They'll run the ball. And here is Harris, fights his way up across the 40-yard line. Short gain of about a yard and a half. So Chrisman in, the 6'6 freshman out of DeKalb High School. Gain of a couple by Harris, second down and eight.
From the Cougar 41-yard line.
Cougars will work from the right side hash mark now. Cenarius stays in the pistol. Nicodemus again, a little motion. Harris again working up the middle. Fights his way to the 45, to the 46. That'll bring up third down and a long three. Now let's see who was else out there now. Sean Moore, redshirt freshman out of Indianapolis Pike, 366 in there on the offensive line. Getting some snaps right now. Sean Ryan, 284-pound senior out of Bishop Dwenger. Third down and four for the Cougars. And they'll have a spread offense, two wide either side, including Gaston up on the near side with Nate Carson. Here's Cenarius, looks to screen the ball, and that was off the fingertips, incomplete, intended for Nicodemus.
Jason Nicodemus is incomplete.
And brings up now fourth down, and the Cougars will punt the ball away with 12-15 remaining, leading at 65-20. Record-setting day as far as points on the board by St. Francis.
On the pump for the Cougars,
and as the saying goes, who would have thunk it back about midway through the first quarter when this was anybody's ball game? And just a shootout, both sides of the ball. Well, the Cougars have continued shooting. But Missouri Valley, they have not scored since that 5:39 mark of the first quarter. Spitnail on again to punt the ball. Got it away, wobbly, now spiral. They'll let it hit at the 20. Takes a bounce inside the 5, down inside the 1. That is where it's going to be touched. And what a job by Spitnail once again. Taking a quick look, Josh Spitnail with through three quarters, one punt for 53 yards. That one, I think, is going to be even better. It'll take it down first and 10 for Missouri Valley. And the ball is actually inside the one-yard line. 12:01 remains. And let's see if Paul Troth is going to make changes to his lineup now in the final minutes here. He's gone all the way so far with freshman quarterback Bridges. And I believe they are going to bring in Dakota Collins And that's always kind of a double-edged sword. Empty backfield once again. Collins, by the way, 6 foot junior. He's thrown for two touchdowns. And sets up out of the shotgun formation about 5 yards deep in the end zone. Looking to throw over the middle. Looking, he's got Henry. He's got the catch. Crossed the 35 and lost the football, but it goes out of, no, did it stay inbounds? Went out at midfield and kicked back, so it'll be out of bounds at the Viking 49-yard line. Oh, how about that big play?
The pass is complete. Fumble falling out of bounds. The ball replaced at the spot of the fumble. First down.
So it is Viking football, first and 10. They're going to move it back, they say, to the 45-yard line of the Vikings, but that, again, is a good for 44 yards with a ball inside the one-yard line. 11:51 remaining in regulation. Vikings trying to find a little bit of a consolation here in the late going of this ball game. Carlin Coleman checks in at right defensive end now. Pistol lineman now, hard count, but USF is not biting. As Dakota Collins now, waiting for the snap. Got a running back, high ball over his head. Has to go back, it's still loose, and he falls on it back around the 26-yard line.
Collins falls on the bad snap.
Well, tough proposition. By the way, they keep Kenny Sanford in there as the running back.
Ball being marked at the 26.
But that one over the just outstretched hands of Dakota Collins. And the loss all the way back to the 26. It'll be second down and 29. Siobhan Richardson stays in wide to the near side. Second down and long. Pistol lineman now set up for Dakota Collins in relief of Jake Bridges. Sanford lined up behind. They'll give the ball to him. Looking to run off tackle. The left side is tripped up and dropped at the 23.
Number 10, Kenny Sanford on the carry.
Give credit for that tackle as Jamal Jackson fought his way through. Had good penetration through the line of scrimmage. Loss of a couple brings up third down and 31. Inside the final 10 minutes of this ball game, as before this snap, boy, the American flag just straight out to the east. Tough day, especially when you're on the short end of a 65-20 score. Collins waiting for the snap once again. Rolls to the right side, draw play coming up, and they've got to Sanford. Again, fighting through there. That was Jackson once again. So he's made two good tackles and plays.
Tackle on the play by 56, Jamal Jackson of the Cougars.
And Baum will come on to kick the ball away. So both teams going with some of the backups here in the latter stages of this ball game. Baum, as we mentioned, has had a busy day punting. He had 5 punts in the game through three quarters.
Cougars number 15, Nate Carson.
He waits back at the 10. Low snap. He dropped the ball and is going to be hit, spun around, and it's loose inside the 5. It'll be picked up, and the Cougars will have it. That it's into the end zone. Let's see. Dutton, touchdown. Fumble recovery by Eric Dutton. Icing on the cake on that ball that eluded Aaron Baum. Deflected into the end zone. And fumble recovery by Eric Dutton. Well, he will cherish that one. Time of the score, 9:04.
No possession of the ball down at the 2-yard line. It'll be first and 10, first and goal for St. Francis at that spot.
They're going to rule the ball down at the 2. St. Francis will have the ball, so no touchdown for Eric Dutton. So close that time, but no cigar, and it remains 65-20. But the Cougar offense will come back onto the field once again. Looks like Cenarius will stay in there as the quarterback. Nate Carson as well. Will Chrisman. They're the two wideouts. Anthony Wilkerson, a 310-pound senior out of Lima Central. Into the ball game on the offensive line. I believe that's P.J. Dean is the running back, flanked to the left of Cenarius. Gaston in motion. They'll flip the ball to him. Here's Charles Gaston trying to turn the corner, and he'll go into the end zone. Charles Gaston on the pass, officially rule a pass from Cenarius, and make that time of the score 8:57. 2-yard touchdown. On the pass, Cenarius to Charles Gaston.
On the depth, the extra point for the Cougars, number 88, Ryan Nix.
71 points by St. Francis in this ball game, and a lead of 51. We'd like to have a bank somewhere you could save a couple of those points. You may need them down the road. Extra point is good. Nix will make it 72-20, and we'll step out with a timeout here at Darcy Stadium. Cougar football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana.
Nothing can stop me. I'm all the way.
Joe Parson at Darcy Stadium, glad you could join us today on this frigid day at Darcy Stadium, and it has been a playoff record-setting day for the University of St. Francis. Trailed several times early in the ball game, never by more than 7 points. Took a lead finally at 21-20, and they have never looked back. Gaston celebrating with his kickoff coverage unit, dancing to the beat, getting ready to kick this ball away. Nix will tee it up, kicking away from left to right. Cougars previously, their best was 58 points in a 58-3 win back in November of 2008. And today, 72 on the board, and we still have 8:57 remaining in this ball game. Well, Pat Donnelly, I think his day is done. He's coming down from the upper press box. Here's a kick. It's going to go out of bounds. Wynn caught that one, and penalty would move it up to the 35-yard line, I believe. That's one of the options that the Vikings will have. And that's where they will spot the football. First and 10 for the Vikings at their own 35-yard line.
They kick out of bounds on the kicking team. The ball will be placed at the 35-yard line. First down.
Well, a lot of things can happen, but you got to feel that when you're up 52 points at home with 8:57 remaining in the ballgame, a lead is pretty safe. St. Francis, with the number 4 ranking, should be home next Saturday against an opponent that'll be identified sometime tomorrow afternoon in quarterfinal play. And let's see if we have another quarterback in there. They're going to stay with Dakota Collins, I believe, and he'll look to hand the ball off. We do have a new running back. That will be no gain. Off tackle run to the left side.
Sean Simmons, the ball carrier.
Sean Simmons checks in as the running back. Simmons, freshman, 5'6", 188 pounds. Has run for 148 yards this year, one rushing touchdown. Has been averaging just over 3 yards a carry. So Simmons in at running back. He looks pretty stocky for 5'6", and 188 pounds. Pistol alignment once again. They've got a running back, also a blocker off to the right wing, H-back in there. It'll be second down and 10. Collins looking off to his right, and whistles blew right as he took the snap. Usually that means false start, but we'll wait and see.
First down, offense number 56. 5 yard penalty, second down.
That one also goes false start against it. The Vikings, Brendan Latham in now, 275-pound sophomore, picks up that penalty.
Second
For St. Francis defensively, Ryan Johnson in at one corner. Schumacher stays in safety. Cougars bunch up in the middle, trying to put pressure on Dakota Collins now on this second down and 15 call. Stretch handoff, gives it off Simmons, wrapped up immediately. That was Matt Muncy that got to him in the backfield first.
Sean Simmons on the carry.
Well, I tell you what, they're going to mark him at the 25. He never got past the 23.
And number 93, Christian Johnson.
Sometimes you wonder about the spots of these footballs.
He's up third down and 20 from the Viking 25-yard line.
That was a generous, generous spot of the football at the 25. Meanwhile, the clock inside of 7.5 minutes, time remaining. Lucas Sparks still out there, by the way. Defensive right end. Hemelgarn as well. And Christian Johnson up front. So the original starting defenders, defensive linemen still out there. And it'll be third down. Third down and 20 from the 25. Collins long count, still 16 on the play clock. Takes the snap. Looks a stretch handoff. No, he wants to throw the ball and pulls it down and then lost the ball. And a scramble for it back around the 17. That's going to be ruled a fumble, but which way? Cougars have got it. It's been that kind of a day. Everything going St. Francis' way. They've had two interceptions that turned into points on the board. Had a fumble recovery, and now another fumble recovery will give them possession at the Missouri Valley. Yeah, it looks to be right just inside the 18-yard line. Let's go with the 18. So the Cougar offense will come back with Clay Cenarius at freshman leading the way. And let's see, we've got Trevon Carr out of Leo High School. In there is one of the wideouts. Nate Carson in wide right, Gaston. Now they get run the ball. And here's a nice run. P.J. Dean inside the 10 to the 5 and down to about the 4-yard line. There's a penalty flag thrown, though, waiting back at the 18-yard line. That one may be coming back. Nice concept of that play call, though. The influence, Gaston in motion from right to left. They faked the little flip to him. He scored, remember, previously in this fourth quarter on that similar play. Then the counter run by Dean running back to the right.
On the play. Holding on the offense number 68. The penalties declined. Holding offense number 69. That penalty will be accepted. 10-yard penalty. We'll play first down.
Now, two penalties. Sean Ryan, that penalty's decline on the hold. And then Wilkerson will be penalized, and the Cougars, that'll move the ball back outside the 25 to the 28-yard line. So it will be first down and 20. Clock inside, 6.5 minutes, time remaining. Carson stays in wide to the right side, Gaston up on the slot now to the right. And under center is Cenarius with two running backs in. They'll run the ball off tackle. Little running room. Dean trying to get to the outside. Steps over one tackle and brings it inside the 15 down to the 14-yard line. Boy, P.J. Dean like a high hurdler. Just a leaping over one tackler on the turf. And he gets all that penalty yardage and more to bring up second down and 6 with the ball at the 14-yard line. Carr stays in as the running back. Dean walking back to the huddle, kind of flexing a leg a little bit. So P.J. Dean stays in as one of the running backs. Carr will set up also at his halfback. And Gaston up on the wing. The give to Dean again. Cuts back left side. Works inside the 10. Still on his feet inside the 5 and down to about the 3, maybe the 2. Now they're going to see the knee hit back around the 4. B.J. Dean, though, running hard this series. He will have the first down. It'll be first and goal.
Angel Ramos. And the result of that play is a good one goal!
And still over 5 minutes remaining. Well, it's a kind of day where you start to think about going to the record books. We know as far as playoffs, this already is a record-setting day. As far as points on the board, previous high was 58. How about the the all-time points scored for St. Francis, as this will be a run into the end zone from 4 yards out by P.J. Dean at the 440 mark. Bill Scott with us. How about your memory? I'm going to let you look that up. But it will be a four-yard touchdown run by Dean at the 440 mark. And I'll tell you what, I'm going to name Seth Coate as my receiving star. Cougars did have 84 against Iowa Wesleyan back in the 2000 season.
First down.
They're not going to allow the touchdown, so they're going to wave that off. How about Seth Coate? And defensively, I would go with, I'll tell you what, Lucas Sparks, I thought, had real good turnaround effort for the Cougars.
14-yard line of the Vikings.
Well, some days you got to take care of everything, especially when you're working alone. I need another arm or two. So no touchdown. It remains 72-20. And it will be a first and goal from the 14-yard line now on the penalty against St. Francis. Gaston in motion. Again, that counter run. Dean coming off to the right side. Cuts it up inside the 10. Spins, back pedals down to about the 70-yard line. Well, P.J. Dean wants that touchdown. Denied on the penalty moments ago.
Number 5, Nate Desimone.
We are down inside 4.5 minutes, time remaining. Just a matter of what the final score will be in the final minutes of this ball game. They'll mark that ball at the just outside the 7. Second and goal from the 7-yard line. It has been strictly handoffs to P.J. Dean. Carr is in there as well. And they'll give to Dean again. We're looking to go off tackle and looking, and he'll skip into the end zone. P.J. Dean this time not denied. And it'll be a touchdown run of 7 yards at the 349 mark. So he does get that touchdown. And that will make it, or is it, are they bringing it back yet again? There is a penalty flag at the 6. No touchdown for P.J. Dean. As an holding call against St. Francis is going to move it back again outside the 15 to the 16-yard line. Well, some days it's just not enough what you do. And P.J. Dean twice has been denied touchdowns, called back on Cougar penalties. Now Cenarius looking and hands it off again. And here's Dean, starts right, cuts back left, still on his feet, wrapped up, got to the 10.
Number 28, P.J.
And will work his way down to the 8. I tell you what, P.J. Dean has run for about 35, 40 yards here in this series of plays. Two touchdowns scored that were called back. And they give it to him again. It'll bring up third down and goal from the 8-yard line. Cougars do huddle up now with just over 3 minutes remaining. Dean and Carr remain in there as the running backs in the backfield. Gaston up on the wing to the right side. Under center, Cenarius. One more time. Here's P.J. Dean looking, drives to the goal line, spins into the end zone. This time, he's not denied. Took him 3 times. 2 touchdowns called back, but a touchdown run at the 255 mark. And finally, P.J. Dean is rewarded.
That sound is brought to you by our friends at Aspen Dentistry.
Hill Nicks has been a busy day as well with kickoffs, with extra points. Had a field goal, too, right before halftime. 27-yarder that made it at that point, 44-20. Now looking to add the 79th point of the day. Boswell, high snap, got it down. Kick is long enough and good. 79-20, St. Francis. And a timeout, 2:55 on the clock. One more time, we'll go back to the studios. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana.
Oh, yeah, I told PJ. I was like, yeah, eat, boy, eat.
Well, facts and figures in any football game kind of jump off. How about 65 unanswered points by St. Francis since trailing, or I should say leading, at 21-20. Yeah, let's change that. How about 59 unanswered points by St. Francis? Well, the Vikings coaching staff, they've had enough as well. Despite the kickoff coming up with 2:55 remaining, they're making their way down from the upper echelons of the press box here at Darcy Stadium.
Number 14, Siobhan Richardson, and number 22.
Pat Donnelly called it a day several minutes ago. Very comfortable with this lead. Here's a return inside the 10. Run by Richardson, got across the 20 to the 25. And it'll be a last gasp opportunity now for the Vikings here before they take that long bus trip, about 9 hours back to Marshall, Missouri. And we'll see. Cougars going to stay with some of their changes defensively. Jamisich stays out there. Also, Ryan Johnson, Matt Muncy, Marcus Stepp has played well today. Jamal Jackson checks in again defensively. And Shannon Swain is also out there now defensively. Schumacher stays out there. They'll drop four back in coverage. And that includes Emmanuel Evans. Let's see if Dakota Evans stays in as the quarterback. He will. Play clock is
penalty marker on the
now
field.
Reset, and now we have a penalty. It's going to go against Missouri Valley. That might have been a legal substitution. It'll cost them 5 yards and the ball back to the 20-yard line. And here we go as Dakota Collins looking to on a reverse, being chased. And they've got to, that's a Henry.
Number 18, Devon Henry.
Devon Henry.
Tackle by number 31, Marcus Stepp.
Marcus Stepp, great play. Stayed at home, tracked it down, and a big loss on that tackle. Back around the
brings up a second down.
Around the 7 or 8 yard line. 8 yard line is where they'll spot it. So it'll be second down and 27 as we have just over 2 minutes remaining. Cougars with all three of their timeouts remaining, and Missouri Valley with two. Collins ready to take the snap once again. Now with play 8 on the play clock. Checks off, looks to his right. Now with 4, with 3. And takes the snap, hands the ball off. And let's see if that's still Sean Simmons in there running the ball. Ran into a wall at about the 6. He's going to lose another yard. That'll take us down to the final minute and a half. Minute 43 actually on the clock. And right now, both teams just wanting to get back in the dressing room with no injuries, warm up. And for Missouri Valley, they'll be thinking about next year as their season will end with a record of 9-3. And the Cougars will go to 10-1 and thinking about next Saturday here at Darcy Stadium and an opponent to be named tomorrow. Here's a left-handed catch of that ball. They'll run the ball off left side. That's a good cutback, and I mean that's Henry in there.
No. David Robinson, the ball carrier.
New number in there. And David Robinson, a 5'9 freshman out of Kansas City, Missouri.
Second line of play by number 20.
It'll be short of the first down by quite a bit. It'll be fourth down at about 16. And they'll have to punt the ball away with under 1 minute time remaining. Nate Carson now will come in to set up as the punt returner for St. Francis at the Cougar 49. Bomb inside the Viking 5 at the 4 to kick the ball away. Cougars still going to keep 10 men up in the line of scrimmage. Here's the quick snap. Rush is coming. And the running up to it, catching it, is Carson at the 45 of Missouri Valley with 23 and a half seconds remaining. And time for just one kneel down, I would think, for St. Francis. And this one will go into the books as a big Cougar victory here And you may find this hard to believe in a 79-20 score, but in comeback fashion here today by St. Francis. Never trailed by more than seven, but three times had to come from behind in the first quarter to eventually lead it at 21-20 and then go on to the 79-20 victory. So Cenarius will assume the victory formation, take the knee, and that is going to do it. So a big, big win. Important statement. It'll be interesting to check with Cougar coach Kevin Downley. We talked about, would there be a fear of some lack of sharpness and because of the week off, not playing last week at the regular season. But really it was more if you want to talk about anything being flat, it might have been from a defensive standpoint. They had trouble covering the speedy receivers for Missouri Valley, and it led to three possessions, three touchdowns for the Vikings, but the Cougars had the answer here today, eventually taking the lead and then saying goodbye, leaving it 79-20 with the final score. We will be back with our postgame coverage and much more as the Cougars improve to 10-1 and the season and the playoff hopes still alive here at Darcy Stadium. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, 106.3 FM, Northeast Indiana.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time we would like to recognize the NAIA Champions of Character representatives from each institution. They were selected by their coaches prior to the game, and from Missouri Valley College, please help us welcome Mark Plummer.
Cougars with an impressive win here on this cool, cool day at Darcy Stadium. Started out 37 degrees and snow showers. The snow has gone. The wind and the cold have not. They are still here. Wind chill about 25, but when you win 79-20, don't mind that cold at all. St. Francis still alive with that number four ranking. And home next week, the thinking will be, and tonight, and a 10-1 year still alive against the opponent that will be named sometime tomorrow afternoon. And a game at 12 noon here at Darcy Stadium. But this game, kind of eventful for St. Francis at the start as Cougars won the toss, deferred. They were going to make Missouri Valley show what they could do offensively, and the Vikings responded with some execution, some great throwing from 5'9 freshman quarterback Jake Bridges, marched his team immediately downfield, set up a Kenny Sanford 16-yard touchdown to the right side to make it 7-0. Cougars, though, answered. They had first a great kick return by Justin Green that gave him good position, a good field position. Then a run by Green would ultimately was set up the first Cougar touchdown of the day, a 5-yard touchdown run by Aaron Harris. But Bridges would respond, a 51-yard bomb to Devon Henry at the 9:13 mark. Johnson with the extra point. Guess what? Vikings back on top, 14-7. But Ferrer to Coate on a spectacular play. 67 yards with Coate fighting off defenders. The final 5 yards into the end zone. 8:53 remained in the quarter. We were in a new game. Knicks added the extra point to make it 14-all. But Bridges would respond again. And it would be Missouri Valley taking the lead on a 16-yard touchdown to Siobhan Richardson, 5:39 remain. But the extra point, no opportunity as it was a fire play on a low snap. It remained 20-14. Vikings had the lead, but a lead only of 6. Justin Green would tie it on a 5-yard touchdown with 3:16 remaining in the quarter. Knicks with the extra point. Guess what? The Cougars were on top for the first time today at 21-20. Just before the end of the quarter. It was Nashawn Lewis with an interception that gave St. Francis possession at the 39. And the first play, actually the first snap, they had a couple of snaps before the end of the quarter, but it would save, pave the way for the first snap in the second quarter. P.J. Dean from a yard out at the 14:57 mark. The Cougars would expand on that one-point lead. They would lead at 27-20, but again, St. Francis could not execute the extra point as a bad snap prevented that. But then Ferrer, 5 yards to Kelsaw, a little touch pass with a sweep left side into the end zone at the 8-11 mark. Knicks with the extra point to make it 34-20. Ferrer then, after the Cougars got possession again, 19 yards to Seth Coate. Highlight film time as he was taking the ball. Difficult catch with his momentum, working to the right side. Basically made kind of a one-handed catch, tipped it to himself. And then with his momentum about to carry him out of bounds, tiptoed down the left side, down the right sidelines, went airborne the final yards, reached out, moving the ball from the right hand to the left hand, reached out and caught the broke the plane of the goal and hit the pylon just before he came down to earth. Knicks with the extra point, 4:13 the time of the score, 41-20, silver and blue. Knicks then would be called upon. He would knock through a 27-yard field goal as time expired, and the Cougars took a 44-20 lead into the halftime dressing room. Missouri Valley had a chance on the kickoff return, fumbled away by Nicodemus. They would take over possession at the 48, but Wilmer Cole would intercept the ball. Second pick of the day for USF. Cole would give possession to USF at the 13-yard line. That would set up a Ferrer to Coate touchdown, the third time on the day those two clicked together. 9 yards on the touchdown at the 8:26 mark. 51-20 USF. Ferrer to McDougal. Again, got away from the defense. Good for 37 yards and a touchdown at the 204 mark. 58-20, a lead of 38 points for St. Francis. Green would romp 49 yards to the pylon, fighting off defenders in the final 5 yards and just leaping for the pylon with 1:17 remaining in the quarter. Cougars up by 45 points, 65-20 as the quarter would end. Then Cenarius would hit a touchdown with a little flip toss to Charles Gaston, sweeping from right to left into the end zone at the 8:57 mark. After a fumble recovery gave the Cougars possession, 72-20, Knicks with the extra point. He would add one more day as P.J. Dean would not be denied. He was denied twice on running touchdowns in the final minutes of this ball game. Finally, with 2:55 remaining, got it in to the for the score. Final points on the day, Knicks would add it. 79-20 is where we are. As the Cougars now with 10-1, their record, and headed back home here in the quarterfinals next Saturday at 12 noon. We'll find out against whom sometime late tomorrow afternoon. Missouri Valley, the Vikings close out a 9-3 season. This is a team you're going to be hearing from in the future. Lots and lots of freshmen, and notably their quarterback, their little guys, 5'9 Jake Bridges, Kenny Sanford, also a 5'9 freshman running back, but a lot of talent and a lot of talented receivers as well, and they will be heard from as the years wear on wearing the uniform of the Vikings of Missouri Valley College. That is going to wrap things up here today. We didn't get a final score. The other MSFA matchup had Robert Morris playing at Marion. Robert Morris, the Eagles came in at 7-3 today against undefeated national, defending national champions Marion, ranked number one again this year at 10-0. And we'll see how that one shakes out as well. But here today, Cougars battle from behind and finally just run away with a record playing playoff setting day as far as points on the board, defeating Missouri Valley 79-20. Special thanks to our studio producer. His name is Robert Scora. My name's Joe Parson. Hopefully we'll get Sean McBride back next week for more Cougar playoff action. That's going to wrap things up. Thanks so very much for listening. So long, everybody.